helpless shock and a season full of wild endings. Corey Holt to the end zone. 6,000 a pop. But when you beat number 11 and you beat number 2, it certainly is special. From 33 yards, that kick is no good! Tennessee wins! And on a traditional homecoming, the goalposts come down in Atlanta. So many years of frustration.
I hope to goodness they don't pull that thing down, because they're just jammed around it.
Acura RL has distinctive styling to appeal to your elegant side. A performance-tuned suspension to satisfy your assertive side. And a sophisticated front and side airbag system to protect both sides. The new RL from Acura.
Nobody loves cars more than I do. Each one is a work of art. So when the maker of all these chose a new antifreeze, it got my attention.
General Motors now uses the DexCool technology of Havoline Extended Life Antifreeze in virtually all its new vehicles. The same patented formula you can use in your car for 5 years or 150,000 miles. So do what GM did. Switch to Havoline.
I use it in my car. I only wish this were it.
To the test, America's most trusted lives up to its name. Die Hard. What's under your hood?
Alex, click on this and check out what's going to be sitting in my living room once I win the ESPN Big Monday Sweepstakes presented by Bud Light.
Brad, who are you kidding? We both know I've got the 411 on college hoops. That bad boy's going to be sitting in my living room.
Just plan to watch the Big Monday games with the man and bring your notebook because you're going to get schooled.
Bring it on.
The ESPN Big Monday Sweepstakes presented by Bud Light. Just log on to ESPN.com. Predict who will win each of the Big Monday College Hoops games and you could win big. Enter now.
Hi, I'm Mario Edwards from Florida State University, and I would like to wish a Merry Christmas to everyone at home in Goshen, Mississippi, and a special Merry Christmas to the University of Miami and Texas A&M. Thank you, guys.
Those two upset part of that wild timeline, December the 5th. At 4:04, UCLA had it in control against the Hurricanes. Heading for Tempe, Arizona thought they were Rose Bowl bound. K-State, well, having to settle for the Sugar Bowl. But two fumbles, four touchdowns. 90 minutes later, UCLA suddenly settling for Pasadena. Arizona knocked out of the BCS. Kansas State getting giddy in St. Louis. Perhaps a taste of the national championship game, and Florida State left thinking, what if? Fast forward now, 7:04, a 15-point lead, 10 minutes left, and K-State's making travel plans for the desert. Florida State, is left thinking, oh well. But at 8:41, the Wildcats were wondering what happened. A&M getting ready for New Orleans, and Florida State getting ready for an invitation to Tempe to play Tennessee for the national championship. Meanwhile, of course, Kansas State slid all the way to the Builders Square Alamo Bowl against Purdue, and the Wildcats and their fans were certainly very bitter about that, complaining about the BCS. What they have to remember is they benefited from the system. The reward seems to sell out of tickets last year when Carolina and UCLA got left out. And the real problem, guys, was the Big 12 Conference did not protect K-State, didn't have a commissioner in place when the bowl pecking order was going through this stuff. That's really the reason. The SEC, the Big East, other conferences would not have let K-State slide down with 11 wins.
Also, Kansas State lost the game.
That too.
No question about it. Kansas State's pass defense had problems all day long with the Texas A&M quarterback, Brandon Stewart. He had 324 yards passing, scored 36 points against them. Uh-oh. If they think he's good, wait till they take a look at this quarterback from Purdue named Drew Brees. Drew, number 15, set a Big Ten single-season passing yards record, throwing the ball all over the place. He also likes the shotgun. Here's a fade cut for a touchdown against Penn State. Nice touch. Now, Purdue might be fifth-ranked team in the Big Ten, but Kirk, they're the best passing team the Big Ten has to offer. I think this is going to be a shootout in the Alamo.
Yeah, they really open up. Plus, they're physical. Yeah, and I agree with you. I think Drew Brees is going to have a big game. Look at Kansas State's defense in the last three games. They've been struggling. They have given up 8 touchdown passes to only 3 interceptions and an average of 18 yards per reception in their last three games. With that defense and the problems they've had, they need to rely once again on the Heisman finalist Michael Bishop to have a big game in order to be able to walk away with a victory. Bishop has averaged, both running and throwing, he's been remarkable. 62 yards a game on the ground with 14 touchdowns running. How about throwing? 237 a game, 23 touchdowns and only 4 picks. That is amazing, and he did it in a very good conference. Now, Kansas State, their fans, they may feel slighted being left out of the BCS. But their fans came through again. They sold out their allotment of seats. They're looking for more seats. Because of that, they will be ready to play this football game. But I agree with Coach. Drew Brees will keep it close. It's going to be a shootout. A lot of points. Kansas State will get it done.
A lot of points produced for you.
A lot of points.
Absolutely.
Both sides.
Yes, sir.
K-State's defense may have been exposed a little bit late in the season. You can watch that game. Intriguing matchup. The Builders Square Alamo Bowl. That's at 8:30 Eastern Time. K-State and Purdue on Tuesday. Meanwhile, Ohio State, despite the suspicion of a lot of people, they might be the best team in the country. They will not get a chance to play for that national championship. It might have been the most consistently dominant team all season long. Did not have a game, played within 15 points, only twice with their opponents within 20 points, but there was that loss to Michigan State. Oh, for that second half back on November the 7th.
We had some dreams shattered in losing to Michigan State. We just slowly walked off the field, kind of looking around, wondering if this was just a bad dream. But it wasn't.
We got ourselves to blame. We lost the game. Nobody else lost it. We're the ones that lost the ball game.
We still feel that we're the same team right now as we were when we were ranked number one. We just had a bad half of football. But that's part of the game.
True character of a football team is to see what happens when you get knocked down. What you gonna do? We came back, destroyed Iowa. We came back and destroyed Michigan. And hopefully we can do the same thing when we play Texas A&M.
Buckeyes and Texas A&M, the match of the kickoff classic, tried to make. Ohio State said no thank you. Now they get them in the Nokia Sugar Bowl. Although Ohio State is technically the home team. They'll have those scarlet unis on. It's going to feel like a road game because the Aggies sold out their tickets, Kirk. And I heard they got about 6,000 of the Buckeye seats. Buckeye fans not that excited about going back to New Orleans.
No, I don't think so. I think they were all expecting to get a chance to go to Tempe. And now they're going to be going down to New Orleans. You know, you think about Ohio State offense, the stereotype is a big offensive line with some great running backs. They've been bucking the trend here in the last 5 or 6 years. Some talented wide receivers, if you look in the NFL. The latest duo, Dee Miller and David Boston. Both these guys have had great years. Dee Miller, nearly 900 yards receiving. On the other side of David Boston, kind of the unsung hero, but he got it done time after time. And David Boston set a school record, 74 catches, over 1,300 yards with 13 touchdowns. Now, Ohio State has big play potential running the ball and throwing the ball. And I think because of that, it's probably the most balanced offense that A&M has seen all year. That's the difference in the game, the Ohio State balance and a dominating defense. They're going to find a way to get it done. They went big over A&M.
Okay, remember one thing. Michigan was number one in the nation against the run when they played Ohio State. But the Buckeyes did something very smart. They come out, first three plays of the game, three passes. And after those passes, they handed the ball to Michael Wiley, and this is what happened. Now, Michael, number 5, went 53 yards for this touchdown. It's the second time he touched the football. Ohio State had 132 yards rushing against Michigan. I like the strategy. Wide open at the beginning, then run the ball and make that play go. I think that might be exactly what they try to do against Texas A&M.
Aggie offense was really struggling until Brandon Stewart got it going against Kansas State, but I don't know, against that Buckeye defense. Not too sure about that. A lot more coming up on our bowl kickoff special.
My name is Jerry Rosinski. I'm a linebacker for the Ohio State Buckeyes, and I want to wish my grandma and my Aunt Eileen up in Hale, Michigan, a very Merry Christmas, and I want them to know that I'm thinking about you, too.
Hi, this is Antoine Winfield, and I want to send out the best wishes
and Merry Christmas to my grandmother, Velma Winfield, and my grandfather, Nathan Winfield, back in Akron.
This is Larry Atkins from UCLA Bruins, and I want to wish everyone in Venice a Merry Christmas.
Hi, I'm Ortiz Jenkins of the Arizona Wildcats. Just want to wish you guys all a happy holidays.
Hi, I'm Tron Cannondale, and Merry Christmas to the whole United States.
And after 13 years, I can finally say I have absolutely no urge to play this game.
New Asteroids is here for PC and PlayStation with 3D graphics, deadlier weapons, and two-player action. It's the most addictive game ever, ever.
Raymond! You're a weak man, Ray.
Asteroids, they're back.
Princeton's three-point sniper, Terrell Baker leads FSU's bomb squad. It's the Rainbow Classic, Princeton versus Florida State, Monday night at 12:30 a.m. on ESPN.
Check out SportsCenter every night for a preview of the 1999 ESPYs and then hit ESPN.com for a full slate of this year's nominees. See how your picks stack up against ESPN's when the awards are televised February 15th. Watch SportsCenter and log on to ESPN.com for a complete ESPY preview.
It was only a year ago, Nebraska playing for a perfect season and a perfect send-off for Tom Osborne and perhaps a piece of the national title. Now, in year one under Frank Solich, three losses playing in the Culligan Holiday Bowl against an Arizona team that was this close to going to the Rose Bowl. Talk about big plays. Trunk candidate for the Wildcats, the best big play running back in the country. He has 12 running plays of 25 yards or longer. Wow. The entire Cornhusker team has a total of 13. You want to know one reason why they're not playing for that national title this year?
Yeah, and they do get the Angelo Evans back, which could help them in that category. Everybody seems to have their finger, their own theory of what went wrong with Nebraska this year. My thought is one of the things that hurt them was they gave up too many big plays through the air. In fact, they gave up 25 plays of 25 yards or more through the air, and that is not good news when you go up against Arizona, who's loaded at wide receiver. Jeremy McDaniel averaged 15 yards a reception, has great speed, but he's also a physical receiver, and Dennis Northcutt, the smaller of the two, also 15 yards a reception. He's a speedster. He gets out, and he can go. Now, Arizona has incredible offensive skill. If Nebraska's tight end is really stopping the passing game of Arizona, they're in trouble because Trunk Candidate will rip them apart with the running game. This will be a war. Both teams are going to score points. High-scoring game. I think Arizona's going to find a way to win at the end.
Yeah, but Nebraska has my two favorite words going for me: urgency and redemption. Why? Because the Big Red has got to quit trying to lose this ball game. They've already lost four one time before. That was in 1968. Whoa. Arizona's got great speed, and I'm not so sure they're not going to outrun urgency and redemption, but we'll see.
Now, I would like to know where urgency and redemption was against Colorado, and that Husker offense really has been struggling. You like Crouch, but they have not been putting a lot of points on the board against good defenses. We'll see how it plays out. The Culligan Holiday Bowl on ESPN Wednesday, 8 o'clock Eastern time, preceded by a half hour from 10 p.m., our bowl game night show from the site of the Fiesta Bowl. Talking about urgency and redemption, Syracuse has played good football to get a chance to play now on this big stage. They want to atone for the embarrassment in the bowl game last year against Kansas State. They had to beat Miami to get to Miami. Now they take on a Florida team that, according to Steve Spurrier, having a little trouble trying to get over that loss to the Seminoles. When they saw how things played out, they knew they were this close to playing for the national championship.
Remember one thing about Florida Gators. They've only lost two games this year. They lost to number one Tennessee, number two Florida State, both away from home. They're an excellent football team. They're led by quarterback Doug Johnson. Now, Doug likes to throw the ball deep. His favorite target is Travis McGriff. Here's a 50-yard touchdown versus the Noles in the first quarter over the top. Now, it's interesting to me to watch the Syracuse defense, how they kind of hang around a chicken coop trying to catch that SEC speed passing game. Both teams are going to score. Big game.
I think both defenses are going to struggle. I agree with you. I think there's going to be some scoring. You look at Syracuse's offense. Look at their quarterback, Donovan McNabb, probably the most diverse attack in the country. They're going to put up some points. Look at the Florida defense right now. They're without Bob Stoops. They're loaded with talent. One thing the Gators have going for them is the X factor, the home field advantage. The Orange Bowl seats about 74,000. I think about at least 60,000 will be Florida Gator fans. The Orange Bowl will become the Swamp. And I tell you, this is a great matchup. As Coach and I just said, lots of points. Florida will get it done. I like the Gators.
McNabb, in his final college game, wants to go out with a major bowl win, something that has eluded him in his career, but a tough place to do it against all those fans with a Gator chomp down there in Miami in the old Orange Bowl. Remember, the game moves back to the old stadium this year. We're coming back on our bowl kickoff special.
Thanks for coming, boys. First, I want you to move the hay over there. Then split and stack that firewood. And paint that barn. And when you're done, I'll give you the six-pack of Coors beer.
Let me get this straight. The hay, the wood, and the barn, for that?
Yep. So what's the catch?
There's only one Mile High taste. Coors, the original.
Come celebrate 20 years of incredible values during Toyotathon's 20th anniversary. It's the best time to find the best value on Camry, the number one selling car in America, with extra value package savings up to $1,100. The biggest celebration of the year is at your Toyota dealer. So don't miss Toyotathon's 20th anniversary going on now.
Temporarily, I work in a cheese place, but I want to play clarinet for a living and write music. Yeah, you want me to name 50 cheeses? Okay. You've got Comté, Swiss Gruyère, Letiva, Scoubine, Coulia, Brie, Brie de Meaux, Mascarpone, a cheese. I don't know, I've seen some cheeses there that I don't believe were of animal origin.
Stretches from now until New Year's Day, Friday, Blane Morgan and Air Force against Brock Heward and Washington in the Jeep Oahu Bowl. Tomorrow at 8, it's West Virginia and Missouri in the Insight.com Bowl. Tuesday, Alabama against Virginia Tech in the American General Music City Bowl. Then at 8:30, a quarterback battle. Bishop against Breeze, Purdue K-State, the Builders Square Alamo Bowl. Wednesday at 3, it's Southern Miss against Idaho in the Humanitarian Bowl. Then at 8 o'clock, Front Candidate in Arizona against Nebraska in the Culligan Holiday Bowl. Thursday is a tripleheader. 1:30, Sean King and Tulane against BYU in the AXA Equitable Liberty Bowl. Then the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, Georgia against Virginia. At 8:30, Little Ricky Williams and Texas Tech take on Mississippi in the Sanford Independence Bowl. And finally, on New Year's Day, Tim Couch and Kentucky battle Penn State in the Outback Bowl.
And ABC picks it up from there. Friday at 4:30, UCLA at Wisconsin, the Granddaddy, the Rose Bowl, presented by AT&T. Friday at 8:30, we talked about it, the Buckeyes and the Aggies in the Nokia Sugar Bowl. Saturday the 2nd, the matchup between the Gators and all those fans against the Orangemen. It's the FedEx Orange Bowl. And then for the national championship, it's the Socitos Fiesta Bowl, Monday, January 4th, Tennessee against Florida State. We are counting down to the Oahu Bowl. It's Washington against Air Force. The Falcons just 2 points from a perfect season. Washington can do some advanced scouting from 99. They got the Falcons as well as Colorado and Oregon, other two teams involved in this doubleheader on the 99 schedule. For a preview, Larry Beal spending his holiday in his home state.
Thanks, Chris. If you're not going to the Rose Bowl as the Pac-10 champion, then spending Christmas Day in Hawaii might be the next best thing. This will be the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl at Aloha Stadium in the shadows of Pearl Harbor. And Todd, an interesting matchup. You've got the perennial Pac-10 power in Washington, size, speed, and strength against an Air Force team that'll drive you nuts with their option.
They will. Unfortunately, they have their starting quarterback, Blane Morgan, back. He has struggled near the end of the season with ankle injury, but now he is 100% healthy. He's 19-3 as a starter, and a lot of people forget the fact that if not for a one-point loss to TCU earlier in the season, we might be talking about Air Force as a BCS contender.
Yeah, Air Force has lost in their last three bowl appearances, and Coach Fisher DeBerry is very serious about winning this game.
We had gotten off to a pretty good start in our bowl appearances, and the last 3 years we've sort of fallen a little on hard times and lost our last three bowl games. So we've tried to evaluate what we've done in the past few years, and this year we've made a solid commitment to trying to be the best prepared we've ever been for a bowl game, and I certainly hope we are.
This will be Brock Ewart's final college game at quarterback for Washington. He's a junior, decided to go pro, and a lot at stake for him.
Last year, a lot of people thought he was going to leave after his sophomore year. This year, not so good. Maybe not a great football decision, but if he can have a big Oahu Bowl game, a 300-yard game, say, he could raise his stock in the eyes of a lot of scouts.
Well, you've opened up all the presents. You've had that big meal. Aloha means kickoff is coming up at 8:30 Eastern for the Jeep Oahu Bowl. Hope you'll join us then. Chris Lee and Kirk back after this.
Large or small, the movies you want to see are on Media One Home Theater. In the blockbuster hit of the century, two people find love aboard an ocean liner bound for destiny in Titanic. When her husband leaves her, Bertie Pruitt returns home to find some unexpected romance in Hope Floats. An angel falls for a mortal but must decide between immortality and love in City of Angels. Some newly designed action figures are creating some big problems in Small Soldiers. Make the viewer's choice. Order pay-per-view on Media One Home Theater.
Outside, it's got more power than any SUV in its class. Inside, it's as quiet as the open plain. Introducing the V6 Grand Vitara from Suzuki.
That's the Suzuki!
I hope she got my good side.
At Oak Park Suzuki, 6440 West Roosevelt Road in Oak Park, 708-386-4100.
The Huskies ride the hot hand of Brock Ewart. Air Force features the firepower of Blane Morgan. The Jeep Oahu Bowl. Washington versus Air Force at 8:30. Tonight on ESPN.
And welcome back. We know that everybody in the world has opened their Christmas presents by now. And if you haven't, what are you waiting for? But before we go here, some final presents, some gifts to some very gifted players who were treated us this season.
You know, there's so many different plays and so many great plays to choose from this year. But the two that separated themselves from the rest, in my mind, were number one, the offensive player of the play of the year by Ortiz Jenkins of Arizona. Time expiring from the 4-yard line, up and over, the game winner, and Arizona gets away with a win. How about LeVar Arrington, the defensive gift? The super freak of the North comes up on fourth and an inch, times his leap perfectly. And I had to throw in Peter Warwick. If you ever need a playmaker and you ever need somebody to make a move and it's third down, look at the move right there. The guy is still on the ground. Meanwhile, Warwick's in the end zone dancing. Peter Warwick is my playmaker of the year. What do you got?
My Scrooge bonehead play of the year goes to the Notre Dame Fighting Irish and how they took a safety against LSU. Now, this is the situation here. It was a good call, but this is one of the worst ways in the history of football to take a safety. In fact, I can tell you 10 better ways to do it without hurting your quarterback. Losing Jarius Jackson cost the Irish a bowl championship series game. And that's why you guys know now that all the Catholic churches during the holiday are taking up the second collection. They're trying to make up for that $10 million the Irish lost by using that plate.
To send the plate around again.
Yeah, send it around.
Scrooge, huh?
Yeah, leave it to him to be the...
Yeah, that was the Grinch that stole about $10.5 million, though, from the coffers there at Notre Dame. I want to give a present to a guy at Kentucky, not Tim Couch, but Hal Mumme. He's got the system. He's got the great quarterback. But I just love him. He's a riverboat gambler. Take you back to the Indiana game. Kentucky early in the season looked dead until he called this fake punt from deep in his own end. And the coach's son, Matt Mumme, throws a touchdown pass. I'm telling you, Kentucky was in trouble. Another gift, the UCLA defense. We get a chance to watch two Bruin games this year. I'm telling you, it may not be nice to leave, but it's true. UCLA's defense made it interesting. They made it exciting. No matter how good Cade McNown was, we saw the overtime classic with Oregon.
Miami.
And we saw that game with Miami in person because UCLA's defense couldn't stop anybody. So a special salute to them. Our final Christmas present to you. We got a Thursday night tradition here, the hidden video, the wild and the wacky that escaped attention on Saturday afternoon. Here are our hidden video plays of the year. Take you back, Indiana, Pennsylvania against Slippery Rock. After Indiana threw a touchdown, an interception, I should say, with a second to go, Randy McCavish, 52 yards, somehow, DJ Flick pulls it in, gets the foot down, Slippery Rock wins it. Number four, Wausau Newman High School against Chippewa Falls. Watch, ball off the foot. They just gave up. The coach yelling at him here. What? What am I supposed to know? Yeah. Number three, CW Post against Stonehill. Eddie Hardaway takes the handoff. Count the zigs and zags here. Did he? Still out. Cuts back. Still zigging. Yeah. Losing more yardage. What? Cutting back. CW Post ends up winning the game 22-20 thanks to Hardaway's run. Number two. Throw out the records when East Mississippi Community College takes on Northwest Mississippi Community College. Michael Poston, the catch here, thinks he hears the whistle. Ah, okay, play's over. Right. Who's the ball? Here's number 17. Yeah, just give the ball to him. Run. It's a live ball. They never blew the play dead. He runs it in for the touchdown. But number one, the play of the year here, Bethune-Cookman, Virginia State. In the seventh overtime, Cook, a little flavor. Win it with some flavor, some style. Dive into the end zone. Take off, big fella. He dove at the five. The play was blown dead. They had the win. They had to play another overtime. Fortunately, for the big guy, Mr. Cook, they won it. They won it in that eighth overtime game, but not before our hidden video play of the century.
Yeah, it has to be.
Oh, a lot more coming up. We're coming back. Down the Oahu Bowl, Air Force and Washington coming up very shortly from the islands. We're coming back.
Another Nokia discovery. Small words are hard to read, which is why at Nokia we make wireless phones with screens that are big, so they're easier to read. Inspired technology with a human touch. Nokia. Connecting people.
Starting tomorrow, Zales is having an after Christmas clearance sale where you can get up to 70% off on a great selection of jewelry throughout the store and get what you really want for up to 70% off starting tomorrow at Zales.
Your parents are always bugging you to get out and exercise, but the last people you want to be like are your parents.
We work here in the ESPN, the magazine shipping department. We really love our jobs because, well, we're sending out a free gift to all the new subscribers.
Subscribe now to ESPN, the magazine, and get 26 issues, a year's worth for just a dollar an issue. That's 66% off the newsstand price. And with your paid subscription, you'll get your very own ESPN, the magazine sweatshirt, absolutely free. Call now,
1-800-504-6644.
It's our last game of the season. The Redskins, the Cowboys, the ESPN Sunday Night Football finale.
That will be, of course, the classic battle. Redskins versus Cowboys.
You don't know your history.
I know history.
The Cowboys never fought the Indians. They had a couple skirmishes, but basically they got along. I still think it's going to be a good football game.
ESPN Sunday Night Football, the Redskins against the Cowboys.
I'm just pointing out that you don't really know your history.
Welcome back to our bowl kickoff special. Closing in now on Washington and Air Force out in the islands there. An Air Force team built not around high-powered offense this time, but really tough defense and a lot of grit.
I tell you what I really like about them, physical conditioning. Watch them. This game will be close. In the fourth quarter, they'll out-condition Washington and win the football game.
The thing I like about Air Force in this football game is they're the underdog. And when they're the underdog, they win football games and bowl games. And I think this is going to be a game where if they cannot get the running game going, Blane Morgan's going to have to throw the ball because the Huskies have dominating talent up front. They're going to probably force the Falcons to throw the ball to win.
Well, I certainly doubted Air Force in the WAC championship game without Blane Morgan. They get it done with the backup quarterback, Cale Bonds. It's tough to doubt Air Force at this point. As we said, just 2 points away from a perfect season. Tomorrow night, we'll come to you from Tucson, the Inside.com Bowl, Missouri and West Virginia. Please enjoy what's left of your Christmas night. Coming up next is the Huskies against the Falcons from the islands. Larry Beal and Todd Christensen with the Aloha Bowl. Enjoy.
Welcome to ESPN's exclusive presentation of Bowl Week.
They've been waiting all year for that one special day. Christmas is here. Santa has delivered. The presents have been opened. The little ones are happy. You're stuffed after that big holiday meal. And now...
Hey, Dad, it's time for football.
What football?
The Oahu Bowl. I don't want to miss it.
Air Force has been a force this season, 11-1. The Falcons of Fisher DeBerry won the Western Athletic Conference Championship. Powered by senior quarterback Blane Morgan, the Falcons have run to glory with the third-best rushing game in the country. Mixing the option with a stealth bomber passing attack, the Air Force is poised for its first 12-win season in history. The Washington Huskies, perennial Pac-10 powers, a roster filled with young pups. The Huskies are guided by quarterback Brock Heward. His next stop is the NFL. Today, a chance to finish his college career on a high note. Aloha! As you look at Diamond Head, we welcome you to the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. As 13th-ranked Air Force, the Western Athletic Conference champions, take on the Washington Huskies from the Pac-10. Mele Kalikimaka and Haole Makahikiho. Larry Beal along with Todd Christensen. The hat gives you that distinguished look I know you've been going for. Spending a week in the islands around the holiday times can't help but be a relaxing experience. But if there's one guy, Todd, who is anything but relaxed this week, it has been Fisher DeBerry, the head coach of Air Force.
Hawaiian intensity, not unlike jumbo shrimp, may seem oxymoronic, and that's what it is. Nonetheless, Fisher DeBerry is somebody who very much wants to win this football game. You saw his 15-year record. A lot of people may not be cognizant of what he has established over the last two campaigns. Very impressive, as you can see right there. But in the postseason, a very different story. They have lost three straight times. So much intensity, Larry, that over the last week, the assistant stayed with the team rather than go out and recruit. Air Force wants to win this game.
Washington wants to win also. As we take a look at their side of the ball, Brock Heward, the quarterback, he's a junior. He'll be playing his final college game for the Huskies today. He's decided to go into the NFL draft. And a win today for the Huskies would be a nice finish to a season filled with growing pains and injuries.
Last year, a lot of people had him rated right behind Leaf and Manning. They were very impressed with his ability to stand the pocket and, of course, all the physical dimensions. Been a very frustrating year for Heward. He just has not been able to do the things that he wanted to do. And he expressed a little bit of his frustration to us earlier.
It takes great perseverance to play this position, and that's something I've learned this year, I think, more than any other year in any of my athletic years from, you know, seventh grade on, because I've never lost five games in a year.
We've got Air Force in Washington ready to celebrate Christmas with a little contact in the Jeep Oahu Bowl. The Shaka sign means just hang loose. The Falcons and Huskies will get loose at Aloha Stadium in just a moment.
Oh, honey, this is the best.
I gotta go, Mom.
What's with the TV?
I don't know, honey. Where's the remote?
Buy Primeco's bonus pack now and get a 100% digital Qualcomm phone, 200 bonus anytime minutes, and a car power charger for only $99.
Call 1-800-PRIMECO. Just when I thought the chance had passed, you go and save the best for last.
The new 1999 Lincoln Town Car. Now only $4.99 a month with zero down payment. And right now, we'll even pay your first month's payment.
Just when I thought the chance had passed.
Ends January 4th.
Go and save the best for
Lincoln, what a luxury car should be.
Welcome back to Hawaii, where we are about to kick off the second of two NCAA games today. I'm Jack Arute, and I'll be covering the sidelines for this Jeep Oahu Bowl. But earlier today, there was the Jeep Aloha Bowl, and what a game it was. 17 seconds into the game, Colorado Buffalo kickback artist, kick return artist Ben Kelly goes all the way. 93 yards, and that was the first 6 points of a 94-point shootout that the Colorado Buffaloes won. Coach Rick Neuheisel, your Colorado team really had to fight all the way.
Yeah, I tell you what, it wasn't over till it was over. We had a comfortable lead, but I knew with Achilles Smith, especially the way he was playing, he really is a great player. I knew it was a long way from over, and frankly, our defense just kind of ran out of gas. But they rose to the occasion at the end when we needed them most.
It came down to a fake punt on fourth down for you. Why did you go that way?
Well, I just felt like our defense was so taxed, they were so tired, that if I had a chance to get me a first down in an easy way, I was going to take my chance. And we came up a little short, and our defense responded and said, don't worry about it, coach, we'll go out and stop them.
What does this victory mean for you?
Well, first of all, it's a great way to send out 13 seniors. But more importantly, for the guys who are coming back, it's a great springboard into 1999. We hope that we can get back in the national scene.
Now, how come you're not out celebrating? I understand you're going to get a clipboard and do something here.
We play Washington next year. I'm going to start working already. But this is going to be another great college football game for everybody involved.
All right, Jack, thanks very much. Jim Lambright leading his Washington Huskies into the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. It's been a difficult season for the coach, although he said his assistant coaches have done the best job he's ever seen at keeping the team focused because they've had to overcome so much adversity, Todd.
Yeah, you know, interesting with regards to Lambright, unlike Fisher DeBerry, who was so intense, he was very laid back and literally, to use the phrase, just happy to be here. That man, on the other hand, well, you know what they say about, you know, swallowing a diamond and you know what else? That man is really uptight. He very much wants to win that game.
Winningest coach in Air Force history is Fisher DeBerry, and he is very focused. David Adams set to boot it away as Washington won the toss and elected to receive. Torrey Butler and Joe Jarzynka waiting deep, and it'll be Butler at the 5-yard line. Out to the 27-yard line. Charlie Jackson on the stop as we take a look at the Washington offense. Brock Ewart has not had much of a running game to help him out, but Willie Hurst has come on at the tail end of the season at tailback. Ewart's favorite target is old buddy from high school, Dane Looker. He was playing college hoops until Ewart recruited him to the Huskies. A lot of beef up front protecting Brock Ewart. A man born to play center is Ken Hutt, who transferred from the Air Force to UW. 10 for Washington, opening possession of the inaugural Jeep Oahu Bowl. Willie Hurst, the tailback, gets the carry over the left side. Out to the 30-yard line. Stopped by C.J. Zanotti as we take a look at the Air Force defense. Bryce Fisher, a man with something to prove. He's from the state of Washington. The Huskies said they didn't want him. He'd like to show them they made a mistake. The Falcons, they don't turn out a ton of pro prospects, but Craig Thorstenson happens to be one of them as we give you the linebackers. 6'2", 242 pounds, good size inside for Thorstenson. In the secondary, Jason Sanderson, like the quarterback of the defense. Falcons will play a lot of zone. See if Brock Ewart can exploit that on 2nd and 7. Complete to Gerald. Jason Sanderson thought he had a touchdown.
Well, it was really a great job by the corner coming up in this case. It was Sma comes up and drops him, and he starts to strip for the ball, but just a little bit too late. The crowd wants the turnover, but a good call by the official. Watch at the end of the play. There's the collision. His knee was already on the ground. The ball bounces up. Everybody's excited, but to no avail.
I'll just call it a 4-yard pickup, so instead of the excitement of quick fireworks here like we had in the first game, a touchdown on the opening kickoff instead. It's merely 3rd and 3 and no scores. The Falcons show blitz. They don't come. Ewart Throws complete. First down yardage for Chris Juergens at the 39-yard line.
Juergens has the dimensions that they like at wide receiver, and Washington certainly likes him as their possession guy. 6'3", 210 pounds. He'll play about a third of the plays and come up with third down catches like that. That's what Washington wants to do. They want to spread Air Force out a little bit, because Air Force's success defensively has been their ability to blitz from a number of different angles.
Here's Brock Ewart, 53% on the completions. 15 touchdowns, 12 interceptions, not the kind of numbers you want if you're trying to launch yourself into an NFL career. First and 10 for the Huskies. And Hurts stumbles in the backfield as he takes the handoff and barely gets back to the line of scrimmage.
Good penetration on the part of Thorstenson as he stood up the fullback, forcing Hurst to trip it up. And you know what, you're right, coming back to Heward as we get a chance to see the replay. Watch number 41 in the middle of your screen come with the bullets, blitz, stuff the fullback. That shakes Hurst up a little bit as he trips over the back leg of the fullback. Heward's numbers are not what everybody had anticipated. That was the man that everybody thought was going to have like a 3,000-yard campaign, 30 touchdowns. It wasn't meant to be, but a lot of it, Larry, in fairness to him, was a lack of a running game.
Well, it took them until their 10th game to rip off a run of more than 15 yards from the line of scrimmage, which is hard to believe when you're talking about the Washington Huskies. They go again on a short pass out into the right flat, and it's Juergens, and he's close to the first down, but just shy, a gain of 9. Travis Meidinger with the stop, the junior from Colorado.
Larry, when I played with Kenny Stabler, one of the things that he used to say is that if they haven't stopped it yet, we'll continue to do it. I remember Mark Van Egan getting about 350 carries on the same play. Here's a situation where Juergens comes out in the flat. Air Force comes with a corner blitz, but they can't do anything with it. Juergens comes up with a very makeable third and very short, and don't be surprised here. This could be an opportunity for play action.
Third down and one, and they go with Marcus Tuiasosopo at quarterback in short yardage situations. Pat Conniff in at fullback out of the eye. And Hurst in motion, the give to Conniff, and he gets the first down out past midfield. Stopped by Thorstenson.
Interesting there, because they actually gave Air Force a little of their own medicine, kind of a veer option thing. And a good job by Tuiasosopo getting the hand off to the fullback. A lot of times, when you're a young quarterback and you come in fresh, you want to handle the ball. Instead, he makes the right decision, gets it to the fullback, gets the first down.
And quickly, Tuiasosopo to the sideline, and they go back with Ewart. It's not quite the kind of two-quarterback system that you see with the Arizona Wildcats, because Tuiasosopo is mostly a short yardage guy. The pitch goes to Hurst running left. He coughs it up, but I believe he was down again, just as we saw earlier.
Yeah, there's a situation where Tuiasosopo is a little bit more of a runner, but of course the reality is that he came upon the national scene last year when up in Seattle, Heward ended up getting hurt, and that man, Tuiasosopo, came off, made the big throws. You can see right at the end, the helmet's down, he's down. Good call by the official. So Tuiasosopo came in, threw for over 200 yards against the eventual national champion, Nebraska, and as a result, he's taken on a leadership role with the Huskies.
Eighth play of this Washington drive coming up, second down and three, as the Huskies have been able to flip it out and use a little brute force to move the ball on this opening drive. 21, Jarzynka in motion. He's going to get the ball around the left side, and he's got speed to burn, exploding past the 30-yard line and inside the 30.
You know, it's funny because Jarzynka looks like the kind of player that should be playing for Air Force. 5'7", 175 pounds, a definite overachiever who can do so many things. There he comes on the little bit of the miniature reverse. Cuts inside. If he could have kept his feet right there, look at that, just gets tripped up by his own man, or he had a chance to go to the house.
Jarzynka, 5'7", 175 from Gig Harbor, Washington. He plays about four different positions, which is why he was the All-Pac-10 All-Purpose Player this season. First and 10 for the Huskies. A little misdirection, and they give the handoff straight up the middle to Hurst as they had Looker on the arc.
You know what, Larry, for the parents out there and for the Jarzynka fans, number 21 of the Huskies, don't think that your son is too little to play. 5'7", 175, he returns kicks, as you pointed out. You'll get to see him later kicking off there. It just isn't as big a deal. There are people that have the large hearts that can play. Jarzynka is certainly one of them. Barry Sanders is going to be the all-time leading rusher in NFL history sometime next year. He's 5'8". Just isn't that big a deal.
Second down and 9 for the Huskies on the opening drive of this opener in the Jeep Oahu Bowl. First ever game at Aloha Stadium. You were taking a long time at the line of scrimmage. Plenty of time to throw, and it's batted down by one of the interior linemen.
Here, the Bryce Fisher was able to get a piece of that. what Washington has done effectively here is they've been able to block the blitz off the corner. And give credit there, because when they go to the one back set, they really don't think that Willie Hurst, the tailback, is any kind of a blocker. But he's been able to do that well, and I would think that that man right there, Lambright, is one of the reasons. If there's ever a guy that preaches toughness, and take a look when we get a chance to see him again, he's got those McGuire forearms working too. Tough guy.
And laser-like eyes. We saw the Huskies on third down. It's third and nine. This is Seward flipping it. Morgan's, and he is dropped on the play by Travis Meidinger.
One thing you're not going to do to the Air Force defense too frequently is fool them. Well disciplined. Take a look. The idea as he rolls to his right is that the flow is supposed to go with him. Well, certainly the linebackers in coverage do. But now when he pivots back, take a look at Meidinger just come like a bolt of lightning. No pun intended. Air Force drop the receiver in his tracks. Great recognition now, forcing the long field goal.
Fourth and 11 after a loss of two. And here is your man, Joe Jarzynka, the little guy who does it all. This will be a 44-yard attempt. And it's blocked. This is a specialty of the Air Force. And that'll roll in for a touchback. No score in the first quarter as the Force comes up with a special teams gem, just as they've done all season long for Fisher DeBerry. So Washington drives, but comes up empty. We'll be back with more of the Jeep Oahu Bowl in just a moment.
Introducing the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, engineered with Quattro Drive, the only system that operates at maximum capability all the time. Another first from Jeep.
It's broken.
How'd you get here?
The all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, the most capable sport utility ever. And Peterson's four-wheel and off-road magazine's 4x4 of the year.
Mile High taste. Coors, the original.
All right, worst day? I was applying to colleges for early decision, and I got accepted, and then, like, 3 weeks later, I got a letter that said I wasn't accepted, and they sent the first one by mistake. And since it was early decision, I'd already, like, canceled all my other stuff, whatever. It was a bad situation. They said they sent it by mistake, and that they were sorry.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of Bowl Week and the 1998 Jeep Oahu Bowl is presented by the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, the most capable sport utility ever.
Welcome back and Merry Christmas. No score in the first quarter of the Jeep Oahu Bowl. Air Force and Washington. Air Force with the ball for the first time in this game. They'll run the triple option, and it'll drive you crazy. Spanky Gillum, the fullback, with the carry on first down. And we'll take a look at the lineups, and we highlight Spanky Gillum. 5'9", 217, packs a wallop, led the Falcons in rushing this year. The Air Force name would suggest an aerial assault, but that's not the case. The Falcons, when they do fly high, the ball generally goes to that man, Matt Farmer. Small, quick offensive line, averaging 6'3", 267 up front. Left tackle James Norman, number 79, all Wacky's best of the bunch. As Morgan will attempt a rare pass intended for Dylan Newman, incomplete. Take a look at the Washington defense. Huskies want to try to clog the middle, jam up the option. Jabari Issa, he'll clog some things up at 6'6", 295. Linebackers will try to contain Blane Morgan. Todd Johnson, a busy man today. He's the Huskies' leading tackler. and we expect he'll make a bunch. The free safety, Akeem Akbar, the last line of defense. He's a freshman facing this kind of option attack for the very first time. When we talked with the coaches for Washington, they were confident in number nine, but when you have a freshman back there against the triple option, it can make you a tad nervous.
Yeah, theory and practice are two different things. This is a very difficult offense to rehearse for, simply because of the fact that you can't duplicate the decision-making process nor the quickness of the backs.
Third and six for the Falcons. It's Morgan on the keeper up the middle, and he's close to the first down marker. Needed to get to about the 39-yard line. We'll have to see where they spot it.
I think he's, you know what, it looks to be that he's a little bit short. This is going to test the gambler in the head coach. And, of course, if indeed it is three and out, then Washington certainly has to feel good about that, despite the fact that Sean Thomas blocked the field goal earlier.
Let's go down to Jack Arute.
Well, Todd, you were alluding to the fact that Fisher DeBerry was not a happy camper all during his time here in Hawaii. Well, it went even longer than that. He was spanked in last year's bowl game, and he never forgot it. So what he did this year is he kept all of his coaches on campus in Colorado Springs. And, you know, that's a big gamble because this is a big recruiting time. He told his coaches he wanted them to focus on developing a game plan for the Washington Huskies and also to get a better rapport with their players.
No question, Jack. Fisher DeBerry very focused this week.
Yeah, that's a good point, Jack. And I think that I would say this, that what they're going to lose in recruiting for being out there 3 or 4 days, they will gain if they win this game.
They did get the first down by inches. They'll throw it out to Farmer on the left side. Breaks a tackle. And out to the 45-yard line. That's not the kind of isolation that we'd necessarily expect from the Falcons. You'd figure that the Huskies will have the advantage in speed and quickness at the skill positions.
One of the things that's interesting about that is the throw is a little bit behind, a little bit weak, and nonetheless, the guys out front. Take a look at the blocks out front for Thomas. Farmer, rather, he makes the catch. There's one block, able to get him out of the way, and there's another one that you didn't get a chance to see for him to get the 9 yards before he tumbles out of bounds. The running backs and skill position people for Air Force are not slackers when it comes to blocking.
It'll be second down and two after the 8-yard pickup. And not in the wishbone, but still running option this point, and that is a dangerous flip that goes out of bounds from Blane Morgan. Normally, he is so precise, but on the pitch, attempted to Scott McKay, a defender, in between.
What ended up happening is that Nigel Burton does a great job of staying with his assignment, and Morgan doesn't see him. Here he goes with the 360. Now he comes out. Right here, he should take it up, because look at Burton. Burton right there. He's with his man all the way, and he's very fortunate there that they were able to get that one back. But as a result, talk about a fortuitous bounce. Air Force ends up with the first down, Larry.
Well, a very dangerous pitch that happened to end up in the right place, out of bounds for a first down. Not the way they designed it. This is the way they designed it, with a first down handoff to Spanky Gillum, 5'9", 217-pound senior from Arkansas, the leading rusher for the Falcons. His given name is Charles. His grandmother called him Spanky.
One of the things that's difficult for Washington, you stop the option in one direction, then it comes in another. When they had played Notre Dame in 1996, Larry, the Notre Dame coaches broke down the film and discovered that they ran the option from 21 different formations. How difficult is that for a defense?
It only seems like a bazillion. Second and five, another dangerous pitch. And gets the first down. The Q, the fastest man on the Air Force roster, with a pickup of nine.
You know what, Larry? I know you're just happy because you're looking forward to saying Quilario. We got some great first names, but here it is once again. Blane Morgan has confidence in his ability. A dangerous pitch, as you pointed out again. He gets whacked. Quilario with the Chuck Foreman 360 breaks out of the tackle of the free safety Akbar and gets across the 40 for another first down.
The Chuck Foreman 360?
It dates me. I understand. I'm a 70s guy.
First and 10 for the Falcons. They'll run out of the eye this time. Play action. Morgan to the air.
Great throw.
Beautiful throw and catch. Complete out of the backfield to Scott McKay.
There is no way that Washington coming into this first particular series would have guessed that Air Force would have already thrown the ball. I think this is, if I'm not mistaken, this is the third or fourth pass of this particular drive. No way Air Force throws this much. But this is the confidence that Bob Knoblet and Fisher DeBerry have in their quarterback. It's the out and up route. They want to take advantage of the rover. What a great throw, right on the money, and not a bad catch by number 30. Lays out, makes sure of it, and of course he wants to make sure of it because he knows he's not going to get that many opportunities.
That is for sure. First and 10 after a 23-yard pickup as they go back to the option game, and it's the same man who just caught the ball, McKay, surging to the 11-yard line. Stopped by Akeem Akbar, the freshman.
Spanky Gillum with the lead block, but this time the pursuit by Washington able to catch up with him. This is part of the frustration, though. You stop at one time, but you're just waiting for something else to break. And now that you realize that Blane Morgan can throw the ball, too, wow, that's really tough on a secondary.
Well, he doesn't throw it a lot. Only 112 attempts for the entire season. Did manage to get 10 touchdowns and with 4 interceptions. Second and 6. Taking it outside now. Jamal Singleton into the end zone. Touchdown. 11 yards. And many of the Falcons fans from nearby Hickam Air Force Base fired up. They have their own little rooting section here.
Amari Lowe, the corner, lost contain. Cut to the outside, able to get in the end zone. Take a look coming to the right of your screen. He's going to have to break one tackle, and that's what he does. There's Lowe right there. He does not maintain the leverage that he needs to, and as a result, on the AstroTurf, able to make the cut in for the touchdown is Singleton.
The second touchdown rushing this season. Jackson Whiting on to attempt the extra point. And Air Force strikes first. Merry Christmas.
Well, Air Force is the group that can do this. They drive you crazy. They can throw. They can go to the inside, but they can go to the outside here. Singleton with the initial six-pointer of the game for the Falcons.
Hi, this is John Oates from Hall & Oates. When I'm in the recording studio, I make sure things sound right.
Hey, guys, that sounds good, but I've got to hear this on my Infinity sound system.
Only Infinity delivers dependable, accurate, natural sound. With Infinity, you can be sure that everything you hear sounds great. There's nothing beyond Infinity.
Infinity. They say the game these days is all about money. Well, not for the beer man. For the beer man, it's still about passion. When I crack open a cold Coors Light, I give 110%. Just like those guys in the Rockies. And when a fan shouts, hey, beer man, that frost-brewed refreshment is delivered like an inside fastball. No, it's not about money.
It's about exercise. I gotta drop some pounds.
Coors Light! Get your Coors Light here!
To prove the power of Interstate Batteries, today I'm racing the family cruiser with my family and a couple of close friends. Currently, we're running third. Make that second, and the battery's doing just fine. Joe and Norm are catching a few rays. Junior's enjoying a race of his own. And looky there, my wife's getting a full makeover. Heck, we got us a regular family outing here.
Interstate, the official battery of the family car.
Flip.
It's a battle of record-setting quarterbacks. Purdue's Drew Brees duels with Kansas State's Michael Bishop. The Builders Square Alamo Bowl. Kansas State versus Purdue at 8:30 Tuesday on ESPN.
Welcome back to Hawaii. That guy's name is Arthur, and Arthur's feeling pretty good right now after Air Force drives 72 yards in 10 plays, eating up 3 minutes and 10 seconds, and using the pass, Todd.
Yeah, that was amazing. Of course, that had to make Arthur feel good. And of course, if you're Arthur, it feels good to be the king.
Jamal Singleton scoring on an 11-yard touchdown run, and think back to the defensive play made by Sean Thomas, blocking the field goal when it looked like Washington had the early momentum. David Adams set to boot it away for the second time today. This is a short kick, end over end. It'll be taken by Butler about the 20-yard line, and they stack him up at midfield. And now he moves the pile out to about the 37-yard line. The Insight.com Bowl is coming up tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, here on ESPN. West Virginia and Missouri. Running back famous Amos Zeroway and quarterback quarterback Mark Bulger leading the Mountaineers. Missouri with Forby Jones, who's always dangerous, and running back Devin West, among the best in the country. The Inside.com Bowl, Saturday on ESPN.
Had a chance to see Famous Amos against Boston College. Two pretty good backs in Amos Zeraway and Mike Cloud. There's rumbling that he may come out. I'd like to see him stay a senior year and see if he can beat out Ricky Williams. Just a personal preference.
First and 10 for the Huskies, trailing 7-0. Ball at their own 36-yard line. Play action fake for Ewan, and he gets hit, and down he goes. Jeff Felton, the Falcon back, a junior out of Georgia, breaking through.
What they've been doing earlier is they've been coming with the single corner blitz. This time they opt for the zone blitz. Watch to the top of your screen, you're going to see two blitzers. And in fairness, the back can only pick up the one. Felton able to slide inside, and Ewan's a dead duck.
Loss of 8 on the play. The battle here is, can Air Force stay in the zone defense and blitz guys selectively from various parts of the field versus Ewart? Will he have enough time to throw against the zone to pick it apart? Second and 18 as Conniff goes in motion. They'll give it to Hurst. Hurst showing good leg strength, able to drive the pile here. Out close to the 40-yard line, Jason Sanderson on the stop, a 12-yard pickup.
Nice job in the delayed counter. Trey is the off tackle and guard, able to pull through the hole and create a big enough cavern that now Heward comes up with a pretty makeable 3rd and 6.
Willie Hurst, one of 8 freshmen to start the season for Washington. And most coaches will tell you, the more freshmen you play, the more mistakes you're going to have and the more losses you're going to have. It's growing pains, and that's what this season has really been about for the Huskies. He's not a good player, but if you have a whole bunch of guys that are not experienced, it can cause some problems. 3rd and 6 for Ewart. Slips down, regains his balance, and then throws high, intended for his favorite target, Dane Looker, at midfield, incomplete.
I think there's the answer to your question that you posed earlier, Larry, and that is as to whether or not they have the confidence to stay in the zone defenses and blitz a little bit. Looker, of course, is a tremendous guy, a former high school teammate of Heward, with 64 catches coming into this game. But nobody has ever accused him of being within shouting distance of a track meet. As opposed to Hooker, their injured receiver, who's not here, who is the NCAA champion, the 55 meters. They really miss him because they need him to stretch the defenses.
And how many teams can say they line up with a Hooker and a Looker at the same time?
Great name.
4th and 6, and the Huskies were punted away. Matt Farmer, the deep man, awaiting the punt from Ryan Fleming.
Nice kick.
There's Farmer retreating, stumbling back to his own 15-yard line and topples forward to the 17. Stopped on the play by Curtis Williams. Coming right back, 7-0 Falcons.
Is this your idea of getting fit? At Gottlieb Health and Fitness Center, we take a different approach to exercise. Our members come in all ages, shapes, and sizes, and we emphasize safety and fun, not drudgery and pain. We'll start you with fitness testing, design a workout plan for you, then give you plenty of help. And here are the fun parts: low-impact aerobics on land and in the water, racquetball, tai chi, and so much more. We're the Healthier Health Club.
For a 12 Days of Fitness gift certificate, give us a call.
Frederick Fallow's advertising budget was going. Wendy Whitehouse was throwing her ad dollars. Pete Peterson's ad money was going. Meanwhile, Harry Hansen put his ad dollars into local cable, and his merchandise is flying off the shelves. Reach your customers with USA Network. Call your local cable advertising sales representative today.
Cowboys.
You don't know your history.
I know history.
The Cowboys never fought the Indians. They had a couple skirmishes, but basically they got along. I still think it's going to be a good football game.
ESPN Sunday Night Football, the Redskins against the Cowboys.
I'm just pointing out that you don't really know your history.
Welcome back to Moon Over Oahu in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Falcons with a 7-0 lead. This was the early momentum changer, Todd.
Big play right here, because you'll see Sean Thomas get the hand up right in the middle and get a piece of it. And, of course, Washington had a lot of confidence because they had driven into field goal range, and it turned right around when Air Force gets the ball and marches down the length of the field to get their initial score. Now, as you see right there, second in block kicks. I also had Virginia Tech earlier in the season. It takes a lot of discipline to block those kicks.
It takes a lot of discipline for the Huskies to keep pounding the fullback as Air Force wants to run Spanky Gillum and run him hard to soften up the interior of that Husky D.
Spanky's hurting a little bit. Maybe it's those pretty blue shoes. Spanky Gillum, I really like him. He was huge in their WAC championship game against BYU, scoring that last touchdown. He's their leading rusher at 5:27 coming into this game.
Second and four. Morgan will keep it. He's got a seam. Moves the shoulder and takes the hit.
Yeah, but you know what? How many quarterbacks do you see do that? I just love that. It's gotta be messed up a little bit when you see. It feels good if you're on offense. As you see Gillum trying to walk it off. Take a look at this quarterback. Do you see him slide? I don't think so. And plus, his brother Bo would never let him hear the end of it. Tucks it under his arm. He's going to lower the shoulder right there. Able to drop him. Got to give Akbar credit. But then again, that's a tough, tough quarterback.
Blane Morgan goes 5'9", 192. Senior out of Carrollton, Texas.
I got to tell you, Larry, that just from a football player standpoint, when you see your quarterback do that, you're willing to dive and do all the things for him, too.
First and 10 for the Falcons. To that Air Force moniker. Now, this is very uncharacteristic for them. A 30-yard gain and part of the bowl preparations for Fisher DeBerry, obviously.
You see, Quilario Brown is just going to run the swing route, and the play action just sucks the linebackers in. Morgan has the great touch. Look at that, just way too late. And that's the man that we talked about right there, the freshman free safety, Akbar, who is not in the coverage he should be. Air Force takes advantage of it.
Well, Morgan is 3 for 4 for 61 yards. You take a look at their passing attack. And now they get a little fancy. It's a reverse to Farmer. The 40 dips outside, and he is dragged down on the play by Wandami Davis, another freshman back in the secondary for the Huskies, a pickup of 9. The Huskies a little off balance here, Todd.
Well, and give credit to Bob Knobloch, the offensive coordinator, and Fisher DeBerry for pulling out the stops. Everybody's so concentrated on the option, and Morgan does such a great job of faking. Let me bring back another name. How about a Jack Mildren or a Rex Kern? He is really fooling people. Give credit there to Farmer. He makes the run, but here's the man, the offensive coordinator. That man Knobloch is just pulling out the stops. You know what? He didn't tell us much yesterday. I should have asked about some of the gadgets.
Here's Morgan. And keep again taking on 3 or 4 Huskies. Wandami Davis again, the first man to make contact. Talk a little bit about this passing attack that all of a sudden we're seeing here for almost the first time. Think about this. Brock Heward threw 62 times against USC. That was one game. It took Morgan 6 games to reach 62 passes.
Well, once again, I think the key stat that I see with regards to Morgan is 19-3. That's not touchdown interception. That's his record as the starter. That's important.
First and 10, they give to hot running Scott Becker in at fullback. Let's go down to Jack Arouche.
Well, let's update you on the condition of Spanky Gillum. Gillum, they're just going to retape his left ankle. He said it was a little stiff and just going to tighten it up a little bit. The same cannot be said for Falcon back number 7, Warren. Chum Warren is still limping around. They took him into the locker room, tried to retape him. He's questionable whether he'll return to the game.
Thanks, Jack. Second down and 6 for the Falcons as Becker, number 44, stays in at the fullback position. They'll fling it again to Farmer. Nice catch and almost breaking free at the 15-yard line, stopped by Torre Butler. Otherwise, that would have been another 6.
Yesterday, the offensive coordinator asked if Farmer was the goods or if he was simply one of those guys that takes advantage of all the play action, a la, say, Tinker Owens when he was at Oklahoma, getting all those guys.
Well, this
stats.
Is an all-time name game for you here.
It's reference city. Yeah, it is. He told me he was. But this is a guy that could go deep and make some plays, as you saw there. Very good hands there on the hitch route.
Another first down for the Falcons. They lead it 7-0. Hit by Akbar. Boy, he was. A whole bunch of purple shirts.
You know, The defensive coordinator, Randy Hart of Washington, when he made reference to Akbar, he said that he is a hitter now who's better at this stage than Lawyer Malloy, the potential Pro Bowl safety. There he is right there in the middle. He was talking about Akbar and the abilities that he had in the secondary, that even though he's a freshman, that he is going to be a good one. He has the potential to play on Sundays.
Second down and five. As you take a look at this drive, Air Force controlling the game and the clock. As Morgan will run the option left. Pitching, and that is Brown. Close to the first down marker. I think he's got it.
But again, who's up to make the hit? That's Akbar again. The young man is really getting his baptism of fire. And as you pointed out earlier, even though the young man makes some mistakes, he makes the mistakes, as they say, aggressively. He comes up and he'll hit you.
Well, how do you get to be 11-1? One way is to capitalize on your opportunities in the red zone, Todd. Look at those numbers.
Yeah, that falls under the heading of impressive. When there's only three times, again, we talk a lot about the discipline of Air Force. They don't leave the ball on the ground. They don't make mistakes. 43 out of 46, that's just unconscious.
And the three times they were unable to convert was only because of missed field goals. They did not turn the ball over. Just shy of the first down. So to set up third and short. Here are the Huskies now, okay? Give me the mindset, because they've obviously spent the past 3 weeks working option, 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 and not thinking a lot about the passing attack that the Falcons have unveiled today.
Well, if I'm the Huskies, I let the quarter run out and regroup.
that's not an option.
Sure it is. They'll bring them back and they'll start the clock. There's 11 seconds left. Yeah, they're definitely on their heels.
Third down conversions, and you see 50% for the season to lead the WAC for the Falcons. One for one today. And Blane Morgan does not like what he sees. He's going to call timeout.
No,
actually, the clock ran down and out.
I wasn't kidding with you, Larry. I told you.
You were right. That was sound strategy. Talk about a balanced attack. One quarter of play in the books, 78 yards rushing for the Falcons, 73 yards passing, and they have a 7-0 lead.
Introducing the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee. With an advanced four-wheel disc anti-lock braking system, it delivers the best stopping ability in its class. And that's good news for everyone. The all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee. The most capable sport utility ever. And Four Wheeler Magazine's Four Wheeler of the Year.
There's no better job than this one. Hey! I get to deliver refreshing frost-brewed Coors Light to my dear friends.
Alex.
And they enjoy it.
Hey, Alex.
Because Coors Light is Rocky Mountain Refreshment, the silver bullet, La Bala de Plata. And I am the one who's got it. Besides, I'm here to please them. And it makes me kind of, popular.
Hey, beer hombre.
A new friend.
Coors Light! Coors Light!
It is more than a trial by fire. It is a rite of passage. And if you can master your fear, outsmart your enemy, and never yield even to yourself, you will be changed forever. The few, the proud, the Marines.
After 40 years in the market, it takes a lot to rattle us.
Call American Century at 1-800-660-0092.
Welcome back, everybody, to the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Air Force in control with a 7-0 lead, looking to try to punch it in again. It's a 9-play drive. And on third and short, the Falcons think they've got it, and the Huskies think the football popped loose on the quarterback sneak. First down.
The officials having none of it. Fumble plays have certainly been controversial of late. Whoa, that's close. That's close. I think what they're going to say, though, is it rolled under his leg. And I'm not sure. Look at that. I'm not sure the Morgan didn't get it anyway. Wow, that's first some balance. Goal.
First and goal from the two. Morgan, the give. And it's Singleton again. His second touchdown of the game. Running a little misdirection, Todd, as he started on the left side. And you figure he's going to come around and run a sweep. And then he just cuts it right back up.
Good job of the point of the attack. You know, I was looking through the statistics here to see, and Singleton is a senior. I think that's one of the reasons why maybe they want to give him some of the gravy.
And there's Spanky Gillum helping with a lead block on the play as Jackson Whiting will attempt the extra point. It's been all Falcons early on. The Huskies had that initial drive, then the blocked field goal, and since then the Air Force offense has been nearly perfect.
Well, as you mentioned, it appeared to be a little bit of a misdirection. Actually, what it was somewhat of a delayed draw. You see Blane Morgan come out. Looks like he might run. There's the hesitation step. Gets single to the ball. Oh, man, look at that. Gillum hits a man in the end zone. That's how far back things have been pushed up. Frank Mindrup, the guard for Air Force, the biggest offensive lineman in their history. He is the real deal. And in talking to some scouts, number 74 has a chance to play at the next level if he can shorten his military commitment. A legitimate All-American lineman.
290 pounds. He's not going to fit in the cockpit. A man who will, Jackaroot.
Well, guys, the Air Force band is going crazy down here, but there's only one problem. There's only two members. You see, the drum and bugle corps from the Air Force Academy was supposed to be brought over here by military transport, but Operation Desert Fox took their aircraft away. So what they've done is they've recruited these two drum majors and this CD player. But they do have good choice in music.
All right. Hey, I tell you what, though, Jack, here's the deal. I got a dollar for every push-up you do. I got a dollar up here for all the push-ups you do when they score points.
nothing Falcons. Jarzynka and Butler again deep. Awaiting the kick from David Adams. Huskies a superb return team this season. Yet another short kick. Jarzynka at the 11-yard line. And there is Joe out to about the 27-yard line. Take a look at the scoring drive as the Falcons had the ball on their own 17-yard line. And they go 83 yards in a little less than 5 minutes. Jamal Singleton, Merry Christmas, Jamal, 2 touchdowns.
Well, coming into this game, we were aware that that was the struggle that Washington had. They had been giving up 400 yards per game. And certainly, they've done nothing to solve that option, attack of Air Force thus far.
Well, if Air Force is going to run the ball and then mix in the pass effectively, it's going to be very difficult to stop them. First and 10 for Washington, down by 2 touchdowns. High formation for Ewer. Gives it to the fullback, Conniff. And the sophomore from Woodinville, Washington, takes it out past the 30-yard line.
And they faked the option. I thought that was interesting. That would have been a shock to see Heward run the option from his position. Good job, though. I was going to say, good job on first down, though, getting some yards, simply because of the fact that, you know, if they can start to get 5 or 6 on first down, they get right back in this game.
Well, there's a long way to go, and with Brock Heward passing the ball, they're certainly in it. Second down and 6 for the Huskies. Falcons showing blitz. Don't come. Short pass. And gets out to the 44-yard line. That's the kind of isolation that the Huskies can possibly exploit getting into the secondary with their speed.
One of the things that Air Force prides itself on is they have corners who can tackle, not just cover. In this case, though, Harris does a great job of making the one man miss and then breaking through and almost going the distance. Finally, at the end there, it's Sanderson who's able to drag him down, but keeping the knees high, a la John Brockington, able to shake loose.
Boy, a veritable plethora of old-timers coming up for Todd Christensen today.
I just always love the way he brought up his knees.
First and 10 after a 13-yard pickup. Braxton Clement now in the game in the backfield as Ewart will roll left and fling it out to Looker at the 50-yard line. Showing a little power as he takes the hit from Tony Jones.
You know, earlier in the season, maybe the highlight of the season for the Washington Huskies in that great come-from-behind win against Arizona State down there when they converted a 4th-and-17 with 29 seconds left. That was a real coming-out party for Looker, number 80, who ended up with, I think, 10 or 11 catches in that game.
Actually, it was an 8-yard pickup. I gave him the first down too quickly there. It'll be 2nd and 2.
Plus, that's a great name. I mean, if he has a Hollywood career in front of him, more power to him, he wouldn't have to change his name. Dane Looker's a great man.
Play action for Ewart. Look right, going deep left. And it's caught. Andre Desashore. 44-yard pickup. And he beat Tim Curry, who's probably the best corner the Falcons have.
And you talked about whether or not they get a chance to go up top. This is what happens. Desashore, they come with the blitz. Take a look. Washington able to pick it up. Good job in the backfield. Ewart has all the time that he needs, and he's able to arc that one. Desashore, the speediest receiver on the core, minus Hooker, goes up, makes sure of it, lands on the elbow. That's a nice catch.
That's a very expensive catch for Desashore. He missed the flight coming over here, had to pay for his own way. $330, so at least he got a reception out of it. First and goal, Marcus Tuiasosopo is into the game at quarterback, as he often does come in short yardage situations. They'll give it to Braxton Clement, and he breezes into the end zone for the touchdown on a 3-yard carry, and he's still waiting for somebody. Well, they're touching him now, but nobody from the Falcons got close.
That was exactly the same play that Air Force ran. A little bit of a delay, the fullback comes in, and boy, Air Force was certainly on their heels. When you go in standing up from 3 yards out, that's dominance by your offensive line. Clement the beneficiary, some stud bolts up front.
And Joe the Toe, Jarzynka, on for the extra point.
I think that's a little David. I think that's Joe the Toe.
Kick is up and good. As we take a look at Braxton Clement, another freshman from Oroville, Washington. His fourth touchdown of the season gets the Huskies back into the game on Oahu.
Introducing the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, engineered with Quattro Drive, the only system that operates at maximum capability all the time. Another first from Jeep.
It's broken.
How'd you get here?
The all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, the most capable sport utility ever. And Four Wheeler Magazine's Four Wheeler of the Year.
This ain't Altoona or Pawtucket, kid, no. Now you're pouring beer in the show. Not just any beer, either. We're talking big leagues, kid. We're talking Coors Light. Wearing this tray out there is like waving a red flag at a bull. 40,000 thirsty fans looking for the coldest beer around. The Rocky Mountain refreshment of frost-brewed Coors Light.
Think you can handle it, kid?
Yeah.
Rookies.
When we created NFL Game Day 99, we used playbooks straight from the NFL teams. Denver's power running attack, Pittsburgh's zone blitz, all the team's special secrets. Entire franchises trust us with their most cherished possessions. Naturally, we keep them under strict lock and key.
Jackpot.
Bro, how we getting down?
We talked about the cavern that was the hole on the run through the left side. Take a look right here, what happens. Just an absolute gap. Great job at the point of attack by both Cadlitz, the center, and, of course, the strong guard, Chad Ward, just moving his man out, as I say. When you come in standing up from 3 yards out, that's dominance by your people up front.
5 plays, 72 yards. We talked about the quick strike capability of the Huskies and Braxton Clement on the 3-yard touchdown run to get the Huskies back in the game. Craig Hawley will kick off. Jarzynka kicks extra points and field goals. Hawley with a stronger foot for the kickoff coverage team. Scott McKay is back, along with Matt Farmer. On a breezy day at Aloha Stadium, the ball hangs up there for a while. It's Farmer. Out to the 32-yard line. On New Year's Day, live at 4:30 Eastern, ABC, the home of the Bowl Championship Series, bringing you the Rose Bowl presented by AT&T. Cade McNown leading fifth-ranked UCLA against Ron Dayne, the Bigot, ninth-ranked Wisconsin. The Rose Bowl, New Year's Day on ABC. I believe you will be there for ESPN Radio.
About to say, for those of you that can't make it to your television sets, tune into your radio where Charlie Steiner and I will carry it for you. That should be a great game.
They're in the cool zone right now on the Huskies' sideline, probably feeling a little bit cooler after getting on the board here. Falcons offense first and 10, and Blane Morgan with nowhere to go on the option.
Good penetration on the part of strong linebacker Jeremiah Farns to break the thing up before it even got started. He didn't make the play, but he was in the backfield. Number four, another one of those great linebackers who's strong and fast coming out of Huskyville, a la Seattle.
Sophomore out of Sacramento, started every game this season.
8 sacks, 14 tackles for loss. He's a player.
Used to being in the backfield. Second down and 10 for Blane Morgan. Huskies shifting at the line of scrimmage just before the snap, and Morgan will throw it again. Flipping it out to Singleton, who's been the offensive star so far, and he's dropped just shy of the 40-yard line by Todd Johnson, the senior from Bellevue, Washington.
That's a big play by Todd Johnson, because what Air Force did is they took everybody to the other side of the field and counted on the fact that man for man, he'd be able to beat somebody. Here's the misdirection. Now he sneaks back out. Everybody's assuming the play is going in one direction. Now take a look. Here's the catch in the open field. It's Johnson and Johnson alone. Great job of breaking down and dropping him, forcing the third down play.
Third and three. Option to the far side. Oh, dangerous. And did he get it?
He didn't.
Polario Brown stopped short. One of the Huskies, I think it was Nigel Burton, tipped it.
Well, remember earlier in the first quarter, that's the same thing that happened. It was Burton that came in, and really he did get just a piece of it, so it's good concentration on the part. Take a look at the tip. Here comes the pitch. You're going to see a man get a hand on it. Right there. There's the pitch. Just breaks it just a little bit there. I think you're right, that was Burton. Brown had to slow down, and of course the pursuit of the Huskies catches up to him. Great job in the open field tackle on the part of Jones.
Fourth and one now, and the Falcons will go for it, or at least they appear to be, from their own 42. Or will they just try to draw the Huskies offsides? The trickery does not work.
I'm really, you know what, frankly, I'm surprised at that, because the way they have been running between the tackles, that short of a distance, I thought maybe they could give it a try. But the thinking on the part of Fisher DeBerry is this: they have the wind with them, the kicking game has been solid. Once again, see if you can make Washington drive the length of the field.
Jason Kirkland, the senior from South Carolina, will come on to punt it away for Fisher DeBerry. And there's Joe the Toe, Joe Everything Jarzynka.
See, that's the reason he doesn't kick off. As you pointed out earlier, he's doing too many things. His leg's tired.
He's got to be tired. The fear that the Huskies have to have is, should he ever get hurt, they would need four guys to replace him.
Wow, nice kick.
And he will almost never fair catch it. At the 13-yard line, squirting up the middle, goes Jarzynka. He's become a cult favorite in Seattle, out past the 32-yard line. 52-yard punt and a 22-yard return. The Huskies will get the ball back, looking to tie it up. 14-7 Falcons on Oahu.
Introducing the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee. While it boasts a new uniframe construction, a quieter, more powerful engine, and an agile suspension for a refined ride, rest assured, it's still as rugged as ever.
Welcome back, sir.
The all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, the most capable sport utility ever. And Peterson's four-wheel and off-road magazine's 4x4 of the year.
Hey, you want passion and romance? Turn on HBO. Because there's real life, And then there's the movies on HBO.
You know what I love about being the beer man?
The equals the act.
The fans. Because when I'm pouring them a cold Coors Light, they're no more courteous, polite.
Ah, the team fight!
Well-mannered people around. I'm giving them a frost-brewed beer, the cool that parched throats. And hey, that's important when you're cheering for your team.
You idiot!
Here you go, sir.
That cheap beer man, thanks a lot. Keep the change.
Aren't they great?
Pontiac! I know where you live!
A whole new era in college football begins. The Bowl Championship Series. Coming January 1st, only on ABC.
Back at Aloha Stadium, the Washington Huskies get set to go back on offense, and this time, hiking the ball back to Brock Cured will be Brad Hutt. Now, you notice the Catlett's was in the last time, guys. What the team intends to do is rotate their two centers. And you know, Todd, that may make the exchange a little dicey now and again.
Very good point, Jack. I frankly don't understand that because of the significance of what you just pointed out. Evidently, both those guys, maybe they can't go the distance.
First and 10. Braxton Clement up the middle. He has spelled Willie Hurst, a tailback, here in the second quarter, and there's your man Hutt. I mean, whether he plays or not, it does not get any better than a center named Hutt.
When I was in college, I played against San Diego State. They had a linebacker by the name of Travis Hitt. Couldn't get any better than that either.
Second down and 8. And there is Hutt, who's a transfer from the Air Force. 6'3", 285 pounds, a senior from Woodinville, Washington. Looks like Ewart is changing the play at the line of scrimmage on second and 8. Gives to Clement on tackle right. And the freshman is dropped almost immediately by Mike Tyler. Mike Tyler, 46 for the Falcons. What a great story. You talk about toughness, you talk about discipline. Well, this guy has played almost the entire season with a torn ACL.
Well, that hasn't kept him from sprinting off to the sidelines. Wow. That's great.
Got a huge knee brace on. It can't get any worse, and he can play with it. Third and 7 for the Huskies. Here comes the blitz. Dumped off quickly and incomplete.
A little bit of panic on the part of Heward there. They came with the blitz. He had a little more time than he anticipated. Wide open on the right side of the field is the corner. Heward feels the blitz coming, decides to go to Reggie Davis, his tight end, throws a little bit behind him. Ball is batted down by Thorsters, Mr. Do-Everything on the Air Force defense, and give Air Force credit. The momentum seemed to have shifted to Washington. The defense takes over with a 3-and-out.
Ryan Fleming will come out to punt it away. Averages 38 yards per punt. Matt Farmer is back at the 25-yard line awaiting the kick. Spiraling to Matt Farmer. And great coverage by the Huskies.
Shows a lot of courage in the part of Farmer, knowing that they're going with a punt block and still is not going to fair catch.
Curtis Williams gets there in a hurry. 39-yard punt, 1-yard return. Back to the Jeep Oahu Bowl in just a moment.
The Discovery Channel store offers you as a Media One customer a 10% discount on almost every item we sell. Just bring your Media One statement to the Discovery Channel store nearest you. Media One. This is broadband. This is the way.
Compared to major networks, cable's the best way to reach people with money to burn. For instance, Comedy Central has one of the highest percentage of viewers who earn over $75,000 a year. So if you wanted to sell something like this to someone like him, you might want to advertise here. Of course, if you wanted to sell something to him, you might want to advertise here. And if you wanted to, you get the picture.
Reach your target audience. Advertise on local cable.
For more information, call 630-716-2440.
Desert when Corby Jones and the Tigers try to counter the shifty moves of West Virginia's famous Amos Zaraway. The Inside.com Bowl. West Virginia versus Missouri at 8 tomorrow on ESPN.
Check out SportsCenter every night for a preview of the 1999 ESPYs and then hit ESPN.com for a full slate of this year's nominees. See how your picks stack up against ESPN's when the awards are televised February 15th. Watch SportsCenter and log on to ESPN.com for a complete ESPY preview.
Welcome back to Aloha Stadium. Larry Beal, Todd Christensen, and Jack Arruda. And there is Arthur the Falcon as you take a look at the Falcon defense and where they rank.
Well, this is really impressive simply because of the fact that, you know, their biggest player on defense is about 275, and that doesn't cut it anymore in contemporary football. The discipline that they have, and of course that's also a credit to Cal McCombs, the great defensive coordinator.
On first and 10, flags fly, to the air goes Morgan. A lot of contact down the field intended for Dylan Newman. No flags deep, but in the backfield.
Looked to me like there's a little bit of motion there, Larry. Trying to go deep with the post. Or it could have been offsides, one or the other.
There you go. 5 yards against the Huskies. You know, we saw Arthur there. Can't get enough shots of Arthur for some reason. He only weighs a pound, that little bird. Huh. 1 pound, but you get the feeling he's a bad bird. He could tear you apart in a second.
So what you're telling me is pound for pound, he's the toughest bird in the house?
Unless you got another Falcon flying around here somewhere. And here's the interesting thing.
Beautiful animals.
I don't know how you flew over, but Arthur, the deal is, he doesn't go in a cage. He's got a human handler that he is perched upon at all times during the flight. That's first class. First and 5, Spanky Gillum. 2-yard gain. Spanky shook off that earlier injury.
You know what, Larry, here in the second quarter, give Washington credit. They have done a good job with their keys, particularly between the tackles. The fullback, of course, sets everything up. If you can stuff the fullback, then you can concentrate on the flanks. Early on, remember, Gillum and a few others were getting some big chunks of yardage. Now, Air Force has had to spread things out a little bit.
Under the 8-minute mark in the first half, the Falcons with a 14-7 lead as Morgan looks over the defense and maybe checking out of the play. He'll pitch it. Jamal Singleton. First down yardage as he tumbles out of bounds past the 40-yard line. Gain of 9.
Again, that's the frustration, Larry, is you do such a great job between the tackles. They get out to the flanks. And, of course, what you're waiting on is you're waiting for the missed blocks. And take a look at the point of attack and watch the blocks out front. Take a look at the fullback. Watch Gillum out front. Does he miss his block? Heck no. And you know the Butler wants no part of that. So with the Ole defense, that enables Singleton to get the extra yardage.
Nigel Burton on the stop. Well, if you saw Spanky coming right at you, I'm not sure you'd be that excited about hitting him either.
Not if I'm 5'10", 180, no.
First and 10. Morgan shakes off the hit from his own fullback as they fake the dive. And he takes it out past the 45-yard line. Jack Arute, what do you got?
Larry, in 1999, when they open up against Villanova, the Air Force Academy will have a quarterback that will not be named Morgan for the first time since 1994. We told the story a lot of times about Blane following his older brother, Bo, to Air Force. But Blane enrolled there to play safety, not quarterback. And I traced it back as to why. When they were growing up, Bo and Blane had matching Dallas Cowboys helmets. Bo's was number 12 for Roger Staubach. Blaine's was number 54 for Randy White, a defensive tackle.
Randy White could hit, and so can Spanky. Spanky surging for another first down. Pickup of 9 into Washington territory.
Well, that might explain earlier. Now, I'm not sure, Jack. Are you sure that wasn't Chuck Howley? But be that as it may, I'm not sure here as I look at the way he lowers his shoulder that he isn't, you know, that could be right. He has kind of a defensive mentality. For the people out there that don't know this, though, Bo Morgan had an opportunity to go to camp in Dallas, and they liked him so much that both Chan Gailey and before him Barry Switzer said he probably would have made the club.
Well, he's got to fulfill his military commitment. First, play action. Going deep again as Morgan has a man. Dylan Newman had a couple of steps, but incomplete. And here's the game plan for Air Force. Pound the option, pound the option, pound the option. When all 11 of those guys in purple are coming up thinking, got to get Morgan, got to get Spanky, all of a sudden you throw the deep ball.
Well, what the situation there is they had what they wanted. They had him on the deep flag route, which is the post all the way across the field. But Morgan's accuracy just a little bit long.
Air Force has rushed for 109 yards in the first half. Morgan 5 of 7 in the air for 79 yards. Second and 10. They'll run the option left, and the option is straight down. Caught in the purple haze. as the Huskies surged up the field. Jeremiah Farms and Jeff Johnson, the linebackers, in on the stop.
I'd have to say that they read that one. It's a great job of waiting for the option. Now watch, he knows that he can't pitch either. There it is. There's Farms. He knows he has no chance. Brown is a little bit too far out front. That's too dangerous a pitch, so he's got to eat it.
So the loss on the play sets up third and 12 for the Falcons. 2 of 3 in third down conversions. This is not an offense designed for third and 12. The give on the counter play to Scott McKay. Coughed up the football, but was he down? Ref says he is down. Stopped by Darrell Daniels, a sophomore from San Fernando, California. And as we talk about a lot of the Huskies, you'll hear us call freshman, sophomore, very young class for Jim Lambright.
Here's what in the old days was known as a cross buck. And as you pointed out, they're not designed for third and 12. The idea there is just to give their punter a better opportunity. Now the pressure really falls on Kirkland with the wind at his back to see if he can either kick it out of bounds or they can down it inside the 15 or 10 yard line.
They've got the pooch punter in now. It's Scott Griffin. Try to pin the Huskies deep. Oh, and it's a fake. Short snap.
Wow.
Jason Sanderson. First down, Air Force.
Now, explain this to me, would you please? You've got this team that's averaging 7.1 yards on first down. You won't go for it on 4th and 6 inches, but when you got 4th and long around 7 or 8, you go for it on the fake punt. This is actually a great catch. This catch is almost not made. Take a look at the short snap. Watch the bobble. Wow, that's a great job of getting over there, and you can say thank goodness for tackified gloves, because down the field Sanderson is able to go follow his blockers and get the first down.
Morgan smothered at the 32. While I look up tackified, I'll tell you there's 4 minutes and 20 seconds to go in the first half.
Oh, you know, the sticky stuff on the gloves.
Okay, all right.
That enabled the ball to stick into that one hand that he stuck out, and he knows right there that he's very fortunate. Great athletic play on the part of Sanderson.
Thank you, Professor. If I'm Fisher DeBerry, the only thing I can say about that fourth down play earlier is field position. They were in their own end. They were about their 40-yard line. Maybe here he felt more comfortable gambling.
However, if he doesn't get it and gives it up at the 40 as opposed to, say, the 5-yard line, that's an awful lot of field position. That could give Washington some momentum, no?
Rushing yards, just what we expected. The Falcons dominating. The cue, Polario Brown, dances his way inside the 25-yard line. Close to, but not quite, at first down yardage. Stopped by Wanda Davis, a redshirt freshman from Denver.
Once again, the misdirection in the counter. Polario Brown looks like he's going in one direction on the motion. Pivots back and takes the handoff. Great job at the point of attack by the offensive lineman. Here it comes. Here's the misdirection. And shoved out of the way. Great job again at the point of attack by Mindrup, among others. A name that we haven't called surprisingly much is Jabari Issa.
The nose tackle unable to stuff the run, but running it down from the backside is Darrell Daniels that time, as he was able to grab Morgan, but it's still a first down just beyond the 20-yard line as the Falcons. That was the 11th play of this drive. When they're working their offense precisely, they will chew up clock.
And that's exactly what's happening here. As it gets under 3 minutes, not only does it appear that Air Force is on the verge of scoring, but they'll give Washington very little time to reciprocate.
Air Force 14-5, the advantage in first downs. First and 10 from just outside the 20. Falcons with a 14-7 lead. They'll pitch it out. Oh, dropped. Recovered by the Huskies, but a flag is down as Brown was unable to handle the pitch. Have to see what the penalty is, because it might negate the turnover. Offsides Washington. Forget about the fumble.
You know, the thing about that, though, is that Blane Morgan makes a great decision. He gets him the pitch with plenty of time, and Brown just drops the ball.
Well, this is a microcosm of the way this season has gone for Jim Lambright. Let's go down to Jackaroot.
Larry, Air Force head coach Fisher DeBerry was all over that flag. Even before it was thrown, he saw the offsides jumping up and down on the sidelines. So he wasn't too excited about that fumble.
Well, Jack, what ended up happening there was that Polario Brown had so much room to run. I think that maybe he, one of those situations where he started to run before he had the ball and just couldn't find the handle. Of course, DeBerry, I think that the anger that you see there isn't necessarily over the call as much as the fact that he had what he wanted in the defensive set and Brown had a chance to go to the house.
First and five instead of a costly turnover. There is Morgan. Oh, they pitch it to McKay coming around the left side. Gets a block. He'll walk into the end zone. He dives in as they close quickly at the goal line, but a 15-yard touchdown. And it looks like one of the officials got taken out in the middle of the field. And he does not look good at all.
This is happening far too often. This is the play, remember, that Air Force ran effectively earlier in the quarter for big yardage. Once again, Bob Knoblet is doing a great job of picking his spots with plays, misdirection, counters, throws, just doing a really nice job.
Still trying to get word on the official that is down. And he's up.
Here's the misdirection. Watch the purple shirts and the direction they go. They're going to over pursuit. Here's coming around on the reverse. Only one opportunity to make the play, and that's Josh Smith. He can't do it. And McKay puts on the speed, and into the end zone he goes.
This is the umpire, Joe Kozak, who went down. And fortunately, he is up. In fact, he's right over the ball as we speak. But boy, for a second, that looked scary. Timeout on the field called by Air Force as we await the extra point. Take a look at that scoring drive. Again, Air Force able to march down the field repeatedly. 12 plays, 69 yards, took over 6 minutes. And the misdirection fooling the Huskies. We talked with the Falcons coaches this week, and they said one of the things they wanted to do was get this quick and athletic Washington team to pursue, and in some cases over-pursue, and then you come back with a misdirection or a counterplay and take advantage of their own athletic ability.
Well, right now, I think everybody anticipated the fact that Washington had bigger, faster guys, but the discipline and the misdirection, and they really have fooled this young defense, Larry. I think that's what that would be the story of the first half. That and the offensive line play, which I think we really need to give credit to.
And don't forget the big play, the fake punt with Sanderson running for 10 yards. A couple of plays have turned this game. One was the blocked field goal when the Huskies were marching on their first possession. And then we had the fake punt, and they'll go for two.
Why, I don't know.
From the eye, it's Morgan. Down the line. Goes in for the two-point play to make it 22-7, kind of unconventional.
Well, all I can think of is the possibility that maybe their kicker is hurt or something to that effect, because certainly, based on the numbers, that makes no sense.
One more look at Scott McKay. Scoring on the misdirection, and the Falcons are in control.
There's a place where you don't have to play the game to win. Where you belong to your ambition and nothing else matters. There's a place where you can do what you love and love what you do. No limits. Welcome to the club. K-Swiss.
Hey, we work here in the ESPN, the magazine shipping department. We really love our jobs because, well, we're sending out a free gift to all the new subscribers.
Subscribe now to ESPN the magazine and get 26 issues, a year's worth for just $1 an issue. That's 66% off the newsstand price. And with your paid subscription, you'll get your very own ESPN the magazine sweatshirt, absolutely free. Call now, 1-800-504-6644.
Welcome back. We flash back in time to a very dangerous return man.
Trey Butler is the one right there who cuts in front of Jarzynka. Cuts to the outside back in September against BYU. He is going to go 98 yards for the touchdown. In fact, in this very same game, Butler had a fumble return for a touchdown. Arguably the biggest game of his career.
Well, the Huskies could use that kind of magic right now, and there is Torrey Butler as they trail 22-7 here in the first half of the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Larry Beal, Todd Christensen, and Jack Arute with you as the shadows have descended on Aloha Stadium. This was game two of our Aloha Classics doubleheader. Short kick taken by Butler at the 12. Has a seam the 30. And dropped at the 45-yard line by the kicker, David Adams.
Some kickers don't want any part of that, but this one did.
36-yard return. Just to let you know, ESPN News is coming up at the half. Highlights of the Aloha Bowl. Chris Berman's two-minute drill. The NFL season winding down, getting serious. Dave Feldman will be at the anchor desk.
You know what? What do we need Chris Berman for? We had Jack Arute to have that. He could go all the way early, remember? Nice job, Jack.
2 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the first half. First and 10 Huskies. Rock Ewart with time. Wide open is Looker at the 30-yard line. And just that fast, here comes Washington. Knocked out of bounds by the senior Tim Curry. A 32-yard pickup.
Air Force in their zone defense gets the deep crossing route, and Ewart gets plenty of time. This time, Air Force decides to rush four, gives Ewart plenty of time. He's able to sit in the pocket, unmolested, deliver the ball right on the money to Looker. That's the deep crossing route. Gets the ball over the linebackers, and number 80 makes a nice catch. Getting out of bounds, preserving the time.
Looker, who says his role model is Wayne Cravett. They're similar type players. First down, outside the 20-yard line. Look out, Ewart is crushed. Fumble recovered by... Washington got back on it.
Well, I tell you what, just as I talked about the fact that they weren't blitzing, this time they come from the backside, and there's just no way Ewart can see this. Take a look. Here comes the blitz. It's Curry come from the backside, just completely untouched, plants his helmet right in the middle of the back. And fortunately, I believe Reggie Davis is the one. Yeah, the ball bounced to him. He's the one able to come up with the recovery.
Boy, Bryce Fisher, big number 78, was there and trying to work that ball. And what's it like when you have a fumble at your feet and you're just trying to grasp, and no matter what you do, you can't get it?
You hope for the best. And what you do is you start screaming your number and your name. 46 Christensen, I've got it. 46 Christensen. In that case, five Davis, I've got it. But you know what? Interestingly enough, we talk a lot about the toughness of a quarterback. Here's the situation where Ewart took a blow.
Let's go down to Jack Arute.
Well, Larry, you know, all through this first half, you've been talking about the fact that Air Force is so disciplined, so focused. They may be a little smaller than the Washington Huskies. The coaching staff at Washington was fully aware of that. In fact, Brad Hunt, who played at Air Force, now is a center for the Washington Huskies. So what did Lambright do? He brought Brad Hunt in front of the team and said, I want you to explain the Air Force way to the Washington Huskies. He said, you're not going to be able to mouth off to these guys. You're not going to be able to play mental tricks with them because they're just tough.
Well, they are tough. And that accounts in part for their 22-7 lead, second and 18 now for the Huskies. Ewart looking left. Now he'll take off. Running room, breaks the tackle at the 20. And down close to the 15-yard line. 13-yard gain for Brock Ewart, so he eats up some of that yardage that was just lost. And the Huskies will take timeout.
Kind of a weak effort on the part of C.J. Zanotti in the middle of the field. Ewart, this time they don't blitz, come with the four. He's got some room in the middle of the field, but if Zanotti breaks down and makes the tackle right here at the 22, instead, kind of a weak effort. And give Ewart credit, he's able to spin out and get some extra yardage.
And Brock Ewart, not known to be the nimblest of foot, but he's not a running quarterback like Tuiasosopo. Just take a look at the timeout situation. The Huskies have one with 1:38 to go here in the first half of the Jeep Oahu Bowl.
We'll give Air Force Force credit, they have given that young man an awful lot of looks, and obviously in the Pac-10, he's played against some pretty good defenses. But Air Force has confused him. He hasn't had the opportunity to do what he needs to do, only 162 total yards thus far. Now a crucial third and five coming up.
Talked about the adversity that he's faced this season. I mean, if you look back at these past Husky teams, pretty easy to hand the ball off to Corey Dillon, Rashan Sheehy, and some of the other talented skill players they've had. The burden has been on Brock Heward, squarely on his shoulders this season. And he admitted, boy, talk about growing pains and learning experiences, but his brother Damon, who is a backup for the Miami Dolphins, said, hey, you know, you could walk into that situation in the NFL. Third down and five for the Huskies. Trailing by 15 points. Big play right here. Heward will throw again. On the slant. It's complete to Desashore. Just shy of the goal line. He wanted the touchdown, but they'll spot it at the one.
Well, not that I have any business giving Scott Linehan, offensive coordinator, any ideas, but Desashore, two catches, two big plays. Maybe this is the reason he's averaging 19.6 yards per catch, is they don't go to him off that often. But Curry was far too far off in that situation. I mean, he was way off the receiver, enabling him to get that slant underneath.
First and goal at the one. Clock running, 1:20 and ticking left in the first half. And they'll give it to Braxton Clemen for the touchdown.
Let me ask you something. I have a theory on this. Follow with me if you would. And that is that if you know you're going to score, your offensive lineman is pretty dominant. They're now going to go two for two because that's what Air Force had to do. What do you think about the idea of the quarterback sneaking and kneeling down and taking some time? Because now what's going to happen is they just scored with 1:15. Look at that. He goes into the end zone easily. Why not kneel down, take up the time, because you know you're going to get it from the one-yard line? Or is that too dangerous for coaches to think about?
I know as a player you were extremely confident. I don't think as a coaching staff, I don't know anybody that would be that confident to sort of say, well, we know we're going to get the touchdown. And then you risk a fumble with additional plays and things like that.
As Washington takes a timeout, think about this. Think about the game, huge game, that most of the people were watching, which was UCLA and Miami. Near the end of the game, they got down to the 1 yard line. They had Edgerrin James. You knew that he was going to pile it, and you just knew it, first and goal. So why not at that point have the quarterback just kind of huddle behind, kneel down, force them to use their timeouts, or if they don't have any, take time off the clock. Because you've got four shots at it, and you're going to go for it because you're down four.
Remember Joe Pisarcik?
Oh, Miracle of the Meadowlands.
you don't want to take additional snaps that you don't need. Just score. Just score, baby.
Well, I guess the thinking is that in a game like that, where obviously the defenses have not done too well, you want to keep them on the field as little as possible. And if you can control the game with your best part of it, which in this case is your offense, you might want to do it. Just future, theory.
All right,
something
Coach
to think about.
Coach Christensen.
Well, no, I thought Gary Danielson made a very cogent point in the WAC championship game when Spanky Gillum ran in for the touchdown. If he'd have kneeled down at the 10-yard line, the game would have been over. Instead, he scores the touchdown, gives BYU a chance to come back. So, a lot of different factors sometimes that we neglect.
Two-point play coming up for Washington. They talked it over. We'll see what they came up with. Motion. Heward rolls that way and fires in and out of his hands. He was hit at the goal line by Tony Jones to break it up.
Once again, the corner blitz right in the face of the quarterback, and the result is that he throws the ball behind. He just didn't have the time. Heward had him open. He had his guy, but the pressure in his face was just a little bit too much, and as you pointed out, limited foot speed. There, right in the face, just right in his chest. Now, here's Jarzynka open. The ball is a little bit behind, almost able to come up with it, but just can't quite make the one-handed stab.
So it's 22-13 now, a nine-point edge for the Falcons. Sunday night, an NFC East matchup on ESPN. The Redskins taking on Emmitt Smith and the Cowboys. And then Monday Night Football on ABC, the Steelers against the Jacksonville Jaguars. Steelers fighting for an AFC wildcard berth. They will have their hands full, however, with the AFC Central leading Jaguars. ESPN and ABC, your primetime home for NFL football.
Larry, we're college guys, but I got to say here, I kind of thought Fred Taylor got robbed. I thought maybe he should have been to the Pro Bowl. Over 1,000 yards, what, 15, 16 touchdowns?
He is a dynamic back.
Well, I think that it's important at the Pro Bowl sometimes to not just You know, to use the line from Casablanca, round up the usual suspects.
Oh, that is a good look, huh?
Speaking of not the usual suspects.
Time for a couple of sit-ups.
What are you talking about? That one app looks good.
There's Brock Yord engineering the drive, but the unconventional two-point play by the Falcons that we still are kind of wondering about ends up working in their favor. Washington had to go for two to keep pace, unable to convert, and so they're down 22-13. Greg Hawley, squib kick. Taken by Becker, and he'll get out past the 40-yard line to the 41. Let's go down to Jack Arute.
Well, guys, you were promoing the NFL on ESPN. Well, look at this situation. The Air Force Academy and their NFL neighbor, the Denver Broncos, seemingly have their success and failure rate intertwined. Over the last couple of years, if the Air Force Academy does well on Saturday, then the Broncos do well on Sunday. Well, I'm a little confused about this week because we're playing on Friday. Now, does that mean that it's a good sign against the Seattle Seahawks for the Broncos, or is it a bad sign for the Air Force because they lost last week, that being the Broncos?
We'll think about that as Blane Morgan throws on a little flip out into the right flat on a misdirection to McKay.
What I needed Jack to explain, that's very interesting, that coincidence, but I wanted Jack to explain to me the squib kick, which I never understand. Now the ball gets run back to the 42-yard line, and 30 yards later you're in field goal position. I never understand the squib kick near the end of the half.
54 seconds left. The Falcons with time to work here at midfield. Becker is in the backfield. Second and one, he gets the first down. That'll stop the clock as it does in college football. So the Falcons will have it with 49 seconds left and a chance to add some more points. I guess, Todd, what they should have done was just kneel down right around the two-yard line. If the Huskies would have done that, they wouldn't be in this situation right now.
You know what? That's a poignant and novel thought by you, Larry Beal.
Yeah.
I wish I'd have thought of
it. Yeah. And a fumble right here. First ball caught by Nigel Burton at the 50-yard line. And they try to drag him out of bounds and do. Nigel Burton, that's the third ball that he's gotten his hands on in this game. The first two were pitches. Now this one, he nabs.
Oh, this is a costly turnover. Morgan, there's the collision, and at the last minute he decides to give him the ball. It ricochets off of Becker's heel into the hands of Burton. Washington really had been unlucky up to this point. Remember, they recovered a fumble that got nullified because of a penalty. Now this time, instead of the ball being in the trenches, it ricochets up into the secondary. Washington in very good situation with 37 seconds left with the ball. And this doesn't happen very often, as you just got a chance to see the turnover margin and that deficit always in the favor of the Falcons.
The Falcons among the best in the country at turning other people over. 37 seconds left for Brock Yord to try to bring his team a little bit closer. He gives on the draw to Braxton Clemen, and they've got him by an ankle. Jeff Howe, a senior, 6'2", 263-pounder, who moved from his linebacker spot to nose guard.
I don't understand that play, Larry, because they've only got one timeout. They can't afford to mess around.
Under 20 seconds to go now. I guess they were trying to catch him by surprise. Now he flings it out to the sideline. It's complete to Gerald Harris. He gets out of bounds. And that's another first down, but with only 12 seconds left, they got to decide whether they want to try to set up a field goal or take a shot at the end zone.
Larry, my mistake. Evidently, they have no timeouts remaining, so that's a great job of Harris in getting out of bounds with 12 seconds left.
Scoreboard says the Huskies do have a timeout left. And we're told now that is incorrect.
Well, a field goal here would be huge, down nine. They've got to score twice.
Looker in motion. See if Ewood goes to the end zone here. Intercepted. Picked off, and this could go back the other way. Jeff Felton has got it. And he has dropped.
Well, this is just a bad throw by Hewer. He had Looker down the seam, tried to catch Air Force by surprise. Instead, he throws it right to the Falcon.
So the Huskies unable to take advantage of the turnover and flip it back over the other way. Well, the clock had run out, And now they're saying they're going to put two more seconds on. So everybody's heading to the locker room and running off the field. Come on back, guys.
You see Heward having the conversation with Looker, and that's about as to when to look, when not to look. And I'm not trying to be funny with the last name of Looker. I'm just saying that he wants to know. Now you can see to the right of your screen, there was Looker in motion. Now here's the throw. Looker's not looking. He's not looking at all. He's running down the field. He finally turns back. An absolute gift interception. And if you could, in credit, give credit to Jarzynka, who comes in and makes the tackle. Let's also give some credit here to Felton. Felton has been in the face of Heward all day in terms of blitzes, and now he's able to make the pick.
And now Todd is finally going to get what he wants, which is the kneel down. You've been calling for this for 5 minutes, 10 minutes of clock time already here. Now they put 4 seconds on the clock. And there is Blane Morgan kneeling down. And the Air Force, in a first half that they dominated with their option attack, sprinkled in with what we'll call the stealth bomber passing attack. They have a lead at 22-13. The Huskies have been able to strike quickly on a couple of occasions, but unable to mount a real long offensive series to get back into the game.
And at the end of the half, the one turnover not costly.
Let's go down to Jackaroot.
Well, Coach, 9 points, is it going to be enough? What are you going to do in the second half changes-wise?
Oh, Jack, it's not enough. I guarantee you that. Boy, they got an explosive offense, but we got to do a little better job of getting some pressure on Heward, and doggone it, we got to get better in our hurry offense. We look like Holigan's goat. Trying to move the ball there. But again, we didn't play a down distance situation, and we let them have the big play. We can't let them have the field position on the kickoff return like we did.
Interesting mix of the option and the passing game. We were a little surprised by that.
Well, you know, that's what we've done all year long, and we just feel like we got to keep them off balance. They're so big and physical up front that we can't just take the ball and hammer it at them. But I think Blane is throwing the ball. I think our protection's been pretty good, you know, and most of the passes that we've laid out there have been big plays for us. Thanks, Coach. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. The Falcons, who average 35 points a game, more than halfway there, a 22-13 lead over the Washington Huskies. Jamal Singleton, the senior, has been the story. He has scored twice. A physical battle in the first ever Oahu Bowl. ESPN News coming up at the half.
Introducing the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, engineered with quadra-drive. The only system that operates at maximum capability all the time. Another first from Jeep.
It's broken.
How'd you get here?
The all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee. The most capable sport utility ever. And 4-Wheeler Magazine's 4-Wheeler of the Year.
In a world where integrity is in short supply and determination is found in small packages marked "Do not open until Christmas," stands a man 14 inches high with a backbone the size of Missouri. Buddy Lee is Buddy Lee in Buddy Lee, Man of Action. A Lee Dungarees production.
On the football field, I can smell fear a mile away. And here I smell fear too. And it stinks.
But I ain't in. I'm afraid to try Zest body wash.
Listen, smelly boy. Zest gets you cleaner, more refreshed.
But I ain't in. I need some serious lather.
Look here. It takes 9 bars to get as much cleaner rinsing lather as Zest body wash with lather thingy.
Get cleaner, more refreshed with Zest body wash.
Now that's zestfully clean.
From the worldwide leader in sports, this is ESPN News.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Feldman. Thanks for watching ESPN News. Merry Christmas. We'll get you caught up on today's sports, and then we'll take you back to the second half of the Oahu Bowl. But first, back to the islands and a shootout at the Aloha Bowl, where Ducks and Buffaloes went at it. Colorado, opening kickoff. They hadn't scored a touchdown in their first drive all season, but hold everything. Colorado's all-Big 12 return man, Ben Kelly, catches it at the 7 and races up the left sideline. And look out, untouched for the touchdown. 7-0 Buffaloes, 93 yards on the return. Second quarter, Colorado up 17-7. The big plays continue. quarterback Mike Muschietti rolls right and fires it to Marcus Stiggers, who Stiggers one way and Stiggers the other way. He's in for a score, 58 yards, 24-7 Buffaloes. Later in the second quarter, Colorado up 27-14 and looking for more. Muschietti finds Darren Cheverini over the middle, who rolls down the sideline, 72 yards, 34-14 Buffaloes. Third quarter, the Buffalo defense wants in on the fun. Damon Wheeler intercepts Achilles Smith and cruises 52 yards for the score. Fifth Oregon turnover of the game, 44-14 Buffaloes. But Oregon would hang around in the third. Achilles Smith hits Jed Weaver, 44-21 Buffs. But still down 51-35 in the fourth. Smith back to the air. He finds Donald Haynes over the middle, makes a move, and look out. 42 yards. They would add a two-point conversion, cutting the lead to 51-43. One last chance for the Ducks. Smith throws behind Bobby Nero on fourth down. It falls incomplete. Smith bummed as Colorado wins 51-43. The Buffaloes have won five consecutive bowl games. Colorado scored 23 points off six Oregon turnovers. By the way, it was the highest scoring Aloha Bowl ever and just 2 points shy of the most total points in any bowl game. Blue-gray bowl. Third quarter, 17-10, blue. Temple's Stacy Mack keeps it on the fake reverse. Down the sideline, diving. Three touchdowns on the day for Mack, 24-10, blue. Fourth quarter, game tied at 24. It's gray ball. Wake Forest's Brian Kuklick finds Auburn's Karsten Bailey, who breaks free for 65 yards. And not just a touchdown, but a little bit of the dirty bird. 31-24 gray, 29 seconds left, blue with one more chance. New Mexico's Graham Lee back to pass, but Auburn's Jason Bray leaps and takes it away. And the gray wins, 31-24. Karsten Bailey was the gray team's MVP. Ended the year as Auburn's career reception leader, although it was the Tigers' worst season since 52. They were 3-8. Michael Basnight of North Carolina A&T ran for 74 yards on 19 carries to earn the Grays outstanding offensive play. You know, Steve Young should be good to go Sunday when the Niners host the Rams in an effort to lock up a first-round home playoff game with Green Bay. Young has a medial ligament sprain in his left knee. He is sore, but he's practicing this week. San Francisco coach Steve Mariucci said that if the Packers lose Sunday in a 1 p.m. game at Chicago, thus clinching a home playoff game for the 49ers, he may limit how much Young plays Sunday. With more football festivities, Chris Berman with his holiday edition of the 2-Minute Drill.
Oh, 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 everybody. Wow, it's been a long night. But you should have seen the Swami's magic carpet outdistance Santa and his reindeer. We had a lot of gifts to deliver. Hope all of you were happy with yours, especially you young girls and boys, because after all, Christmas is for you. It's a time of year when we sip a little eggnog and reflect on what's going on. And I got to tell you, when it comes to the NFL, there's sure a lot of gifts given out. Why, just this morning in the snow of Minnesota, I'm sure I saw Randall Cunningham say to Randy Moss, just run to that Douglas fir tree over there and I'll hit you with a bomb. Sure enough, these two have been at it all day and all night and all season for that matter. And if one of these passes happens to be incomplete, Randall says to Randy, hey, forget the Douglas fir, run to the bird tree this time. Sure enough, that works for a long touchdown. What about the gift of perfection? What Denver did to tempt fate, not to mention the record of the 1972 Miami Dolphins, was one of the truly great feats of this or any other year. 13-0, while defending your Super Bowl crown, Mike Shanahan, John Elway, and company, thank you for your gift of dreaming of reaching the unreachable star. Not to mention Terrell Davis and his quest for 2,000 yards. How about the sheer joy of unwrapping the present that's been Doug Flutie? 8 years in the Great White North, and he responds with this? He's far from the sugar plum fairy too many teams thought he was in the past. He's the reason the Bills have been dreaming playoffs since an 0-3 start. How about wrapping your present in old wrapping paper, like old AFL uniforms, and returning to the playoffs 2 years after you were 1-15? Quite a present Bill Parcells and his troops have given to New York Jet fans. Speaking of coming from nowhere, those Atlanta Falcons have been quite a surprise package. Running, throwing, and the defense. Now, if we could just give Dan Reeves our heartfelt holiday wishes for a speedy recovery, I'm sure it'll help. How about the possible playoff gift from places that never, ever have a right to dream about such things? Like in Arizona, where Jake Plummer has helped put Christmas lights on the cacti. And in New Orleans, where Mike Ditka has hung mistletoe all over Bourbon Street. And how about watching the old Warriors remain at the top of their craft, like Bruce Smith in Buffalo?
Reggie White in Green Bay, whose sack total is truly the gift of surprise. And Steve Young, supposedly one hit away from a career decision, throwing and running as good as, if not better, than he ever done it. But we could go on and on and on, because not only tis the season to be jolly, tis a season full of great gifts and many surprises, all wrapped with a bow. Thank you all for your giving spirit at this time of year. The Swami needs a gift or two this final week to assure himself of a playoff bid after squandering a big lead earlier on. In the spirit of the season, we fully expect to get them. Here are our holiday tidings. Here I heard the Swami exclaim as he rode out of sight, Merry Christmas to all, and to all, a good night.
Thank you, Boomer. The Falcons have not won a bowl game since 1991, but they're up over the Huskies, 22-13. Back with more.
Put to the test, America's most trusted lives up to its name. Die Hard. What's under your hood?
Giving NFL Game Day 99 better graphics and gameplay was easy. The hard part was deciding between all the new end zone celebrations.
Party!
That's nice.
Looking good, Terrell.
No! I ain't dead!
It's fine.
Less is more. But hey, when the results are game this real, it's worth the trouble.
Please.
Hey.
Thank you.
Nobody loves cars more than I do. Each one is a work of art. So when the maker of all these chose a new antifreeze, it got my attention.
General Motors now uses the deck school technology of Havoline Extended Life Antifreeze in virtually all its new vehicles. The same patented formula you can use in your car for 5 years or 150,000 miles. So do what GM did. Switch to Havoline.
I used it in my car. I only wish this were it.
Hockey fans, Flyers and Blackhawks on the deuce, 8 p.m. Eastern time. Flyers are unbeaten in their last six, 3 wins, 3 ties, including a 3-1 win over Chicago last Saturday afternoon in Philly. Hockey tomorrow. Lightning center Chris Gratton has been suspended 3 games by the NHL after referee Paul Stewart accused Gratton of spitting on him near the conclusion of the Lightning's 2-0 loss to the Sabres. Gratton was unavailable for comment but released a statement with the Lightning denying that he spat on Stewart. A reminder that we've got more football. Sunday night, Skins, Cowboys. Two teams that don't like each other. Redskins are done. Is North Turner? Find out Sunday night on ESPN. You are at halftime. The Falcons lead the Huskies 22-13. For those of you on ESPN, back to Larry Beal and Todd Christensen. For those of you on news, we'll see you right after the break.
Imagine TV.
Wow, look at all this inventory. If we could just think of a big name for a sale, we could get all these clothes out. Closeout!
Announcing the Mercury Year-End Closeout, where you can get a hot new 1999 Cougar for only $16,595. With its front-wheel drive, available V6, and sophisticated suspension, street legal right now at your Mercury dealer.
What do you think, the red or the blue?
The tie.
Imagine yourself in a Mercury.
Can I look?
Go ahead.
Unique gifts for explorers of all ages, only at the Discovery Channel store. For the store nearest you, call 1-877-DCI-STORE.
You'd think that after 9 exhausting months of teaching, Emma Browning would be tired of classrooms.
But Emma is just one of hundreds of Northwest teachers who return each summer to the University of Washington for special programs that challenge, teach new techniques, and improve personal skills. So that teachers like Emma, in turn, can make education more meaningful to all our children. The University of Washington. Who benefits? Our community and the future.
Cool.
Located just north of Colorado Springs, Colorado, the primary purpose of the United States Air Force Academy is to develop and inspire air and space leaders with vision for tomorrow. All cadets participate in a demanding four-year program of academic studies, leadership, military training, athletics, and character development. The Academy provides graduates with the experience and knowledge to lead the Air Force into the 21st century.
Welcome back. We are at the half. Merry Christmas, everybody. The first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl, and the Air Force Falcons are one half away from enjoying the present that they so dearly want with a 22-13 lead over the Washington Huskies. Now, many of you may know that I happen to be from Hawaii, lived here for many, many years, and have so much pride when talking about the beauty of the Hawaiian Islands. For those of you watching back east, maybe a little bit cold right now, enjoy with me now a slice of paradise, a glimpse of Hawaii.
This is our island of Oahu. Magnificent mountain ranges crash into the pounding surf. 125 miles of beaches ring the island like a lay of white sand. Oahu is beauty and adventure, culture and cuisine, love and romance, and of course, action. The island of Oahu is where people come to play. From the screaming surf of the Banzai Pipeline to exploring spectacular terrain, there's an adventure waiting for you. Learn to catch a wave or dive beneath them. Challenge the mountains or harness the trade winds. No matter which way you turn, the island of Oahu challenges you to have fun. If you're looking for challenges the whole family can enjoy, they're everywhere. Most of the island of Oahu is lush and natural. Hundreds of hiking trails to explore. There are more than 30 championship and resort golf courses, including the most difficult in the nation. And of course, picture-perfect beaches to indulge in the most ideal of island pastimes, doing nothing at all. And for the kids, this really is paradise. Oahu is sandcastles and surfing, dolphins, and shave ice. Memories they'll treasure for a lifetime.
Well, Santa has done his job today. The Falcons and the Huskies are not finished yet in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. We'll come back, take a look at the halftime highlights in just a moment.
Coffee.
Easy.
NyQuil.
Relief. So we'll wake up to a good morning.
Honey.
Happy anniversary! It's the NyQuil 30th, and we're topping our good mornings with spectacular ones. Win our $30,000 good morning getaway. To enter, identify this famous voice.
NyQuil, the nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head fever, so you can rest and have a good morning medicine.
Where do you want to wake up? Details where you buy NyQuil.
And after 13 years, I can finally say, I have absolutely no urge to play this game.
New Asteroids is here for PC and PlayStation with 3D graphics, deadlier weapons, and two-player action. It's the most addictive game ever, ever.
Raymond! You're a weak man, Ray.
Asteroids, they're back.
Welcome back, everybody, to the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. The Air Force Falcons at the half leading the Washington Huskies by a score of 22-13. And the Falcons, we told you earlier how determined they were, how intense they were, how focused they were on coming to paradise and not thinking about the beach, not thinking about the distractions, but focusing on running that option and sprinkling in the passing game. And it has paid off for them through the first 30 minutes. On the other hand, for the Washington Huskies, sort of a microcosm of their season coming in at 6-5. We take a look at the key plays, and Todd Christensen, right here, a fumble that wasn't.
Absolutely, this has got to be a 14-point turnaround because of the offsides, the play came back, and then McKay on the reverse is able to go in for the touchdown. Really, there have been a lot of key plays in the first half, but that certainly has to be the biggest because it gives the Air Force their 9-point lead.
It was a lot easier getting that Santa hat on you than it was doing up your tie at halftime, big boy.
Yeah, you're right. A little bit of conversation out there. Everybody wanting to know whether or not Heward was the real deal, which I thought was interesting because I've had the chance to see Couch earlier in the season. We look at the statistics. He struggled a little bit in the first half, but the running game of the Falcons continues to be dominant. And the big statistic that I see right there, Larry, 6.5 yards on a first down affords the Falcons the opportunity to do all the play action that you made reference to.
So far, the Huskies have been kept off balance by the Air Force option attack and that stealth passing attack sprinkled in. Brock Heward will get another shot at the Falcons, trailing 22-13. Back with more at the half in just a moment.
Prices low, minutes grow at Harry Miller Appliances. We have the lowest prices on major brands, including Amana, Maytag, Speed Queen, and Frigidaire. Plus, we've been in business since 1921. That's over 75 years of product knowledge to share with you. And unlike other stores, we offer immediate delivery and service to our customers. Our showroom and warehouse are always fully stocked to assure a wide selection and the quickest delivery possible. Come see why these reasons make Harry Miller Appliances at 3900 West 127th Street in Alsip the best buy for Amana and more.
Hope floats on Media One Home Theater. The prom queen takes a nosedive.
Bertie, Billy and I are having an affair.
And returns home.
I invited Justin to dinner. Not the time.
Well, well, well. Bertie.
To find more than herself.
I really don't want you to kiss me right now.
Hope floats. Make the viewer's choice. Order pay-per-view on Media One Home Theater.
Here's some food for thought. A little bit of guidance from the citizenship.
Through sports, alliance.
When you're on the field, keep one thing in check. Be a good sport and focus on respect. Respect? That's right, ain't it a trip? It's all about
teamwork
and sportsmanship. When you're on the court, use your intellect and be a good sport, focus on respect.
I'm Sid Dempsey, president of the NCAA, and I want you to focus on respect.
Welcome back to ESPN's exclusive presentation of Bowl Week.
Coach Jim Lambright, Washington Huskies, what'd you tell them in the locker room?
That we move in and zero in on what they did to us in the first half. We got a great chance. I think my staff did a good job of halftime adjustments. And
like what sort of adjustments are you going to make, Coach?
Mainly defense and picking up the things other than the option. The option isn't hurting us right now.
Now, what about offensively? What do you want to try and accomplish there with Brock?
We got to end up getting the ball outside on run, and we got to shut down their outside blitzes.
Todd, Larry?
All right, thanks, Jack. Remains to be seen whether the Huskies can actually make those adjustments, Todd. Again, only 3 weeks to prepare for the option attack, and in concentrating all of their efforts on that, Air Force has been able to strike with the passing game.
And one of the things that at halftime that I had a chance to visit with some of the Air Force brass, about not literally brass, but some of the people in charge of making decisions, is that Fisher DeBerry really stresses trying to get something established in the first drive of the third quarter. He's very, very determined to get that right. And I was told that they'll be very disappointed if they don't go down and score. And I tell you what, Larry, you know, we talked about intensity at the top with regards to Fisher DeBerry. We didn't understate it.
We are getting set for the start of the third quarter in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Larry Beal, Todd Christensen, and Jack Arute down on the sidelines as Air Force controlled the first half, 22-13. They've got the option game going, although Jim Lambright said, we didn't give up big plays on the option. Certainly the Huskies have concentrated their defensive efforts on bottling that up. Here is Farmer backpedaling and retreating to his goal line, taking the kickoff. Running room up the middle, doesn't get as many yards as it first appeared he might out to the 29-yard line.
It's important not to hold right in front of the official, which is what just happened, and that ball is going to move back 10 yards.
Nick Olszewski on the stop, and the flag is going to march the Falcons back on their opening possession.
If you're going to do it, you got to be away from the main man.
On the return, we have holding. On the return, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
So the Falcons will start from their own 15-yard line.
And Fisher DeBerry doesn't miss a trick. If you noted, he came over the side and said, okay, what's the number on that guy? He wanted to know. He's in on every detail.
He is meticulous. That's part of the Air Force way. Attention to detail at all times. First down Falcons, and Blane Morgan will follow Spanky Gillum on a quick closing hole up the middle for a pickup of two.
Many people that watch this feel like it looks like it might be a busted play. It is not. You fake to the fullback and you follow him into the hole with your quarterback. It's not a quarterback draw, it's a design play, but Washington will stuff it.
And don't pass out when you look at the passing numbers for Blane Morgan, 6 of 8. They could go a whole game without throwing 8 passes at times. Never mind completing 6 of them.
Well, as Fisher DeBerry pointed out, it's not that they throw more, but they throw it better.
Second down and 8. Off a play action. Oh, wide open is the cue. Colerio Brown at the 40-yard line, ridden down from behind by Akeem Akbar. And Blane Morgan slow to get up as he took a shot right around the 10-yard line.
This is a play that they ran in the first quarter. Remember, they victimized Akbar at free safety, who bites on the play. Watch the left of your screen. Here it comes, and he took a shot from the backside. Here's the throw, and there's Akbar in pursuit again. Colario Brown able to get downfield, a big play for Air Force.
Pickup of 28 yards. We'll have to keep an eye on Blane Morgan to see if he's shaken up. First and 10. They'll give it to Gillum off the right side, and he's smothered by a gang of Huskies.
One of the things about Morgan, don't forget, is that the last couple of weeks of the season, he was victimized by a sprained ankle. In fact, he didn't start against BYU, but before things could get out of hand, he came back, and they said that they were guessing that maybe he was 60%. But he gutted it out, and they won that ball game, and they said he's 95% coming into this game.
Yeah, they beat BYU 20-13 in a game that was very, very tight, where they never were able to really get the option attack going. Made a couple of big plays down the stretch. On 2nd and 7, down the line he comes. The pitch to Colerio Brown again. And he drives close to the first down marker, short by about 3 yards.
Well, again, you know, as you pointed out, you know, the big plays that were made in that game, of course, Spanky Gillum busted through on the one fullback play, but the screen that went for about 50 yards, that was the big play of the game, and again in the passing game. So Fisher DeBerry pointed out he's not afraid to let Morgan air it out. He trusts his arm.
You know, the cheerleaders will always say we're number one, but this is a Falcons team that was 1 point away from being 12-0 this season, a 1-point loss to TCU in the middle of the season. Otherwise, they might have figured in the bowl championship series. Rushing yardage, what we would expect from the Falcons, and Washington has had problems getting that attack going all season long.
Check out my man, 3-1.
Here is Becker fighting for the tough yardage, and he gets the first down. Scott Becker, the sophomore from Granger, Indiana, stopped on the play by Todd Johnson. but Air Force able to move the ball with that option attack.
How many tough guys do you think of that wear number 44 and play fullback? Just offhand, I'm thinking of Bob Christian, Rob Conrad, guys like that. I mean, there's always a number 44 who's a tough guy that gets you hard yards between the tackles.
Well, you have to have wide shoulders to wear 44 because the numbers come out far apart.
It's my high school number, Holmes.
Play action for Morgan again, going to the air. Incomplete at the 8-yard line, intended for Dylan Newman. On the coverage was Torrey Butler, and some of the Falcon fans wanted interference.
Butler did a great job of closing. He got fooled by the play action fake, but Butler is able to catch up. Watch. He gets fooled. There's the slant. Now he turns around. Watch the burst that he makes to the ball right there. He's right with him. Does stumble a little bit, but of course the issue there, that was a catchable ball. That ball could have been caught, so you can't throw the flag on Butler. Good non-call by the official.
So it'll be second down and 10 for the Falcons. Option down the line right. The pitch is Scott McKay. And he rumbles down about the 33-yard line. Hakeem Akbar, we talked about him early in the game. The freshman, 6'1", 195 out of Riverside, California, had 15 tackles against UCLA, but all kinds of pressure on him to come up and support against the run, and you keep getting sucked up towards the line of scrimmage, and then over the top.
So many times you think of a free safety as a center fielder, but in reality, more and more, because of the running attacks and the passing attacks and the 8-9 in the box, your free safety has to be a hitter. Akbar is that, but right now his coverage skills are
fine. Call a third and a short two from the 33-yard line of Washington. They'll give on the counterplay to Jamal Singleton, and he is not getting even close to that first down marker. The senior from San Antonio smothered on the play, and Fisher DeBerry will have a decision to make here on fourth and two.
There is no decision. He's going to go for it. The field goal kicker is not going to kick one from 50, and they're certainly not going to punt it at the 32.5-yard line.
Todd Johnson was the first man to make contact. See what Coach DeBerry comes up with here. Some coaches like to pound it up the middle on short yardage, but the wide side of the field is to the left of Blane Morgan. See if they decide to take advantage of that. Fumble off the ground. Oh, a fortuitous bounce. Close to, but I do not believe that he got the first down.
Great pursuit at the point of the attack by Washington. They penetrated the backfield, broke the play up, and even though the bounce came up to Brown, the pursuit of Washington was too much. Great defensive stand for the Huskies, and that might turn a little of the momentum, Larry.
Marcus Hairston on the stop.
But here at the point of attack, there it's broken down. Right at the point of attack by Nigel Burton, the Roverback, who's able to come in. Brown cannot get the first down, and now Washington, who struggled late in the second quarter, has a great opportunity to get momentum.
Day yet. Even the dogs won't move. Still no radio contact and supplies are running low.
Mom? I brought you some cookies and some nice hot cocoa. Bye-bye, dear.
No matter how bad conditions get, there are a few things you can always count on. The Go Anywhere Jeep Cherokee is just one of them. Now get a Cherokee and get all these features at no extra charge.
There's a place where you don't have to play the game to win. Where you belong to your ambition and nothing else matters. There's a place where you can do what you love and love what you do. No limits. Welcome to the club. Case yours.
The fluffy white cumulus clouds hanging over Aloha Stadium. This first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. 22-13, Falcons with the lead. Huskies trying to get back in. They've got the ball after stopping Air Force on downs, and Ewart will throw quickly out to the sideline, and it's Dane Looker, and he fumbles it out of bounds. A lot of guys having a hard time holding on to the ball.
I'm not sure that maybe he didn't do that on purpose. He got an additional 3 yards.
It usually doesn't work out quite that well. Jeff Felton on the stop.
Well, no, but I mean, he's so close to the sideline, maybe he's figuring that. Happened to me years ago in a game against Kansas City. I fumbled out of bounds at the 18-yard line to stop the clock.
Intentionally?
Yep. You hear a smattering of boos out there. They did. They moved it back.
That's right. They caught him. Second down and 7 for Washington. On a delay, it's Willie Hurst. He hasn't seen much action since the first quarter and stopped by Bryce Fisher. One of the few times we've called his name in this game. Big number 78 up front and right tackle for the Falcons. 6'2", 275. What a character Bryce Fisher is. He's from Renton, Washington, and has talked about how, hey, they didn't want me. The Huskies didn't want me. I got something to prove here today. I want to show them. He was a skinny guy, just over 200 pounds. He's really bulked up.
Not anymore. The skinny guy part.
Oh, yeah.
And he's a player, too.
Oh, he absolutely is a player. 3rd and 5 for Washington. Here comes the blitz by the Falcons. And down.
Oh, man.
Jason Blevins wrapped him up. 3rd sack by Air Force today.
Well, if he's a relation to Dean Blevins, then Dean's got to be proud, because, man, did this guy hit right under the chin. Pow! Man, a quarterback, that's when the job's not fun. That was a real hit there.
So 4th down and 11 for the Huskies. Ryan Fleming will punt it away to Matt Farmer, waiting at his 25-yard line.
Bank.
It is
no!
Wide open. Had a man wide open at the 35-yard line and just could not get the ball to him. Devin Johnson was all by himself.
Now, here's what happens. Ryan Fleming, the punter, all right, is not used to this kind of pressure. Watch the pressure get to him from this side. They're going to come in his face, and he's going to be in too big of a hurry. Watch this. Oh, my gosh, I got to get rid of it, got to get rid of it, got to get rid of it. Oh, no, 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 no. And there's no way that he can get back and make the play. They would have had an easy first down. Great call, courageous call on the part of Lambright. And you see him shaking his hand. All Fleming had to do was sit there and throw it downfield. He'd have had it, but he just couldn't do it.
Well, he could have thrown the ball straight up in the air because the Falcons were coming hard. And here is Blane Morgan running hard inside, down to the 30-yard line and inside to the 26. And there is Fleming, who's going to be thinking about this forever.
The unhappiest guy there. And you know what I got to tell you? Those are really token pats. When people come over and go, yeah, that's okay. You know they don't mean it. That could have been a gigantic play for the Huskies.
Did you get a lot of those pats?
In the one game in my career in college where I fumbled 3 times, no. They just left me alone. You'd have thought I had leprosy.
2nd down and 3. And again, the Huskies, they had their moments. And this is the way the whole season has gone for them. So close yet so far. Blane Morgan play action. Throws the dying quail end over end. And that bounces at the 10-yard line. Intended for Scott McKay, but not a good-looking pass right there.
Well, the thing is that Scott McKay gets actually tackled at the line of scrimmage. They would have had a touchdown. Take a look. You're going to see him come through. There's the stop. Now watch right there. Look at the hold right there by Towns, the inside linebacker. And you're right, that is an ugly kind of, that makes a Joe Cap pass look beautiful. But Towns smart enough to get a piece of him to not allow him to come unfettered and catch the ball.
Well, I'm going to say there was a little bit of contact there, and Blane Morgan might have gotten hit as he threw. Oh, another dangerous pitch to McKay, throwing it over the top of defenders. Now, you watch Air Force film as Lester Towns made the stop. You don't see them throwing the ball over the top of people on the option.
No, that says a lot for Washington in terms of their ability to make their reads and stay with their discipline. See right there, you can see Todd Johnson staying with his man, but out of bounds. It's going to be short. It'll be an interesting call here. I think they're going to go for the field goal here, but 42 yards, that's about the maximum distance here.
And Lester Towns limps off the field. He's been bothered by foot and ankle injuries all year.
Strange situation with regards to Towns. He dropped a 45-pound plate on his foot lifting.
That's what created the injury.
That is not good for you. 42-yard field goal attempt. Has the distance.
Wow.
On the money. Jackson Whiting connects. And the Falcons are able to add to their lead. 25-13 on the Jeep Oahu Bowl.
This is John Oates from Hall & Oates. When I'm in the recording studio, I make sure things sound right.
Hey, guys, that sounds good, but I've got to hear this on my Infinity sound system.
Only Infinity delivers dependable, accurate, natural sound. With Infinity, you can be sure that everything you hear sounds great. There's nothing beyond Infinity.
You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh, the fundamental things apply, as time
bold yet very smooth, Beaulieu Vineyard Wines, 100 years of passionate winemaking.
UV
dungarees. Buddy, we tested. Can't bust them.
Eric Crouch and the Cornhuskers attack Arizona's two-headed monster in this offensive showdown. The Culligan Holiday Bowl, Nebraska versus Arizona at 8, Wednesday on ESPN.
Merry Christmas to you on this Christmas Day, first ever Oahu Bowl. A lot of people have a lot of wishes on this day, among them, Bryce Fisher.
You guys want me to be your guys' next game day announcer? Forget about Lee Corso. Forget about Brian Herbstreit. You want Bryce Fisher? I'm excited.
He's excited. He didn't know it was Kirk Herbstreit instead of Brian Herbstreit. Flag down as the kick goes out of bounds, taken at the 35-yard line. But this guy's got quite a personality. I think he might have an NFL future before a television future.
He reminds me a little bit. Remember on the old Laughing Johnny Brown? He's got that look about it. Well, a lot of personality.
You're really going back in time with all of your references.
Come on.
This is a time warp game.
Stop dating me, man. Come on. Just let me enjoy this.
Bryce Fisher, the WAC Defensive Player of the Year. Ask him how he put on all that weight, another 50 pounds, you know, since he first joined up at the academy. He said, I hang around with fat guys. They eat a lot. First and 10, Willie Hurst takes the pitch running right for the Huskies. He's going nowhere. Stopped by Bryce Fisher, among others. Let's go down to Jackaroot.
Guys, you got to give a call to the defense for the Air Force Academy. They played well, and it's thanks to this man right there, Cal McCombs. He's leading the Air Force Academy, but he says one of the things that he does every Thursday, including yesterday here on Hawaii, he gets his defense together and says, all right, gentlemen, now, you devise the offense to beat our defense. He says these guys are in engineering school. They come up with some incredible ideas.
Thanks, Jack. It was funny. Yeah, interesting concept that they do that and let the players get involved in game planning. Second down and 9. After that first 1 yard gain, throwing it out, and there was Jarzynka breaking a couple tackles. And he'll be 2 yards shy of the first down marker as C.J. Zanotti came over to finish him off.
Larry, so many times when you talk to both offensive and defensive coordinators, they always talk about their limitations, what they can and can't do with their particular people based on age. The one thing that Cal McCombs stressed with regards to his defense, and he has put together some great defenses there at Air Force, is that these guys are so bright that there's nothing that he can't put in. No stunt, no blitz, no coverage, nothing that he can't put in to utilize the skills that they have.
Third and 2. Huskies need a drive here. Falcons show blitz, and here they come, but Heward has time. Intercepted. Jim Curry's got it, weaving his way at the 45-yard line. 36-yard line. Tim Curry, the senior from Seattle, ruining Jim Lambright's day. He had one interception during the season. This is his second.
Well, in both cases, these are really poor throws, and the idea that Heward could go out on a really good note right now doesn't look so good. That ball just floats on him a little bit, and I think maybe he was waiting for Jarzynka to come back inside a little bit. Curry does a nice job with the return, making a couple of stiff arms, but that certainly didn't look like a good throw, and Curry, a native of Seattle, Washington, has to feel pretty good about putting one on a team that obviously didn't recruit him either, right?
Well, it's the same story. There are several players from the Washington area. Bryce Fisher, we just talked about a moment ago, saying, okay, how do you like me now?
Yeah, that's right. That's a very impressive stat that you saw just there. 13 different players with interceptions.
First and 10. Oh, a little seam for Blane Morgan, but couldn't quite get there as they were able to tackle him. Jafar Williams on the stop. Let's go down to Jackaroot.
Well, guys, you talk about that interception by Tim Curry. He wanted to go play at Washington, but they didn't recruit him. All Washington told him is, look, you're invited to be part of our walk-on group. He thought better of that, and then he decided to enroll at the Air Force Academy. Now, there's 33 states represented at the Air Force Academy, but the kids like Fisher and Curry that come from Washington, today is very special.
If I'm Curry, I'd say walk on this.
Second and 8. Morgan on the keeper will pitch it out. And that is Singleton. A nice open field tackle on the far sideline by Torre Butler.
The block, the wide receiver comes down and the corner is off. Now take a look. He's going to be able to come off the corner and make the hit. Ooh, man. Boy, that hurts. You got to be Brendan Jones. You got to say, where did that come from? You're not supposed to be 10 yards downfield and be able to come back and make the hit.
It's lunchtime. It is crunch time. Play coming in a little bit late here for the Falcons. They're going to have to.
I believe that was Mike Barron who's the one that came in under his chin. Boy, that was a whack.
Have to get to the line here quick. Here's Morgan straight up the middle. Has the first down. To the 20-yard line. Todd, you talked about earlier, there's so many different ways that you can run the option, so many different variations, and that's just one of them where you follow the fullback through. He doesn't have the ball. He's a lead blocker for you.
Absolutely. And Morgan has run that effectively throughout the year.
Blane Morgan, the WAC Offensive Player of the Year of the Mountain Division, third leading rusher for the Falcons as we take a look at their numbers. Inside the 20-yard line, the red zone, very effective. Penetration in the backfield messes up the play. Spanky Gillum was upended almost immediately. And there is the first time that we've called Jabari Issa's name.
And that's a man they can't afford to have down, if that's Mindrup, I believe it is, number 74.
Yeah, the senior from Parker, Colorado, biggest lineman that the Falcons have at 6'5", 290. He had knee surgery before the season started, and the coaches were saying he would be tremendous, but he's had to play his way into shape. Has never really been 100%.
Well, if he's not 100%, I certainly like his 85, 90, or 92, or whatever it is he's playing at, because the young man from Parker, Colorado, is an excellent offensive lineman.
Take a look and see what happened.
Take a look. You saw he gets pulled down. In that case, right there, he gets pulled down by Eason. Of course, his helmet, he gets then kicked in the helmet by the back, shakes him up a little bit. But, you know, here's the interesting thing about offensive linemen. I'm always entertained by the fact that when quarterbacks or running backs go to the side, all of a sudden there's two or three different trainers. When an offensive lineman comes out, are you okay? Shake it off. Inevitably, I'm always impressed as I go to the various and sundry campuses. The guys with the great grade point averages almost always are offensive linemen. And my theory on that is because you have to toil in so much anonymity, that helps your ability to study.
Second and 9. Morgan, oh, he has a man wide open. It's McKay at the 15. Driven out of bounds at the 5-yard line. A little misdirection, get him going left, and then throw it back to the right side.
They've been able to do that all day long. The keys that Washington has to read, they end up getting fooled. Take a look. McKay is going to be coming right at you as Morgan rolls left, comes back to the right. It looks a little bit like kind of the half rolls that you used to see in the run and shoot. McKay cuts up field. He's had a great day and made some big plays for Air Force.
McKay with three catches for 47 yards in this game. Scored the one touchdown already. First and goal from just inside the five-yard line for the Falcons. That's Spanky Gillum. Touchdown. Gillum with his sixth rushing touchdown of the season. This is a guy who always gets positive yardage.
Take a look at the point of attack. There it is. White shirts are pushing purple shirts. Gillum easily into the end zone. And again, I mentioned that on the other side of the ball, it makes sense because Washington has so many 300-pounders. But when you average just a little over 260 on your offensive line to be that dominant, very impressive, Larry.
Very impressive indeed as the Falcons add to their lead. Spanky Gillum spanking the Huskies 32-13.
Large or small, the movies you want to see are on Media One Home Theater. In the blockbuster hit of the century, two people find love aboard an ocean liner bound for destiny in Titanic. When her husband leaves her, Bertie Pruitt returns home to find some unexpected romance in Hope Floats. An angel falls for a mortal but must decide between immortality and love in City of Angels. Some newly designed action figures are creating some big problems in small soldiers. Make the viewer's choice. Order pay-per-view on Media One Home Theater.
With a powerful V6 engine and enticing new looks, the attraction is completely understandable. Introducing the V6 Grand Vitara from Suzuki.
Wow, that's a Suzuki?
Okay, guys, that's fine, thanks. Fellas, that's plenty.
At Oak Park Suzuki, 6440 West Roosevelt Road in Oak Park, 708-386-4100.
And Sunday Night Football. This week, it's another chapter in a classic rivalry when the Skins look to derail the Cowboys' quest for a division title. ESPN Sunday Night Football. Coverage begins at 8:15.
Now that sounds exciting.
Welcome back to the Jeep Oahu Bowl. Larry Beal, Todd Christensen, Jack Arroot down on the sidelines. 32-13, the force has been with them, and now the burden falls on Brock Heward and the Huskies to try to get back into this game. David Adams, squib kick, another one that goes out of bounds.
You know, coming into this game, I think you pointed out earlier, Larry, the fact that Washington was second in the nation in kickoff returns, but still with a 19-point lead. I wouldn't be kicking it out of bounds.
On Tuesday, ESPN presents a bowl game doubleheader. First from Nashville, the American General Music City Bowl, number 24 Virginia Tech, facing Alabama at 5 Eastern. And then it's the Builders Square Alamo Bowl from San Antonio, number 4 Kansas State, meeting Purdue. You know that Kansas State feels like they have something to prove. Be sure to catch Bowl Week Doubleheader Tuesday on ESPN.
Now check this out. This is very interesting. Rarely do they take this, but because of the fact that they have such confidence in Jarzynka and Butler, they want to make Air Force kick again. So instead of taking the great field position, they're going to make them kick to either Butler or Jarzynka and see if they can create a big play.
Well, they need some big plays right now. Down 32-13. There's little Joe. Since you're going back in time when all your references, the Bonanza theme. Little Joe? You're living in about the late 70s, early 80s, my friend.
All right, I'll have a later reference. I got you covered.
So we'll make him kick it again. David Adams. From the 30 this time. And it is Jarzynka at the 10-yard line. Butler, the blocker in front. And the ball almost stripped from behind. And the Huskies don't get the yardage they had hoped. In fact, they lose 7 yards by passing up the penalty. Stopped on the play by Tim Curry.
Jarzynka trying to make something happen. Coming from the back here, making the attempt to strip. Well, I think the ball actually does, no, it doesn't come loose. Good job by Little Joe.
I'll tell you, he is diminutive, to use one of the words you like, 5'7".
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter.
I saw him yesterday. I'll tell you the story in a second here. Here comes Curry showing blitz from the left corner. And now he backs out of it as Ewert will change the play. A little chess game going on here. Straight ahead, Braxton Clement, who gets hit almost immediately after getting the ball by Mike Tyler and falls forward for a gain of about 3.
Well, I think everybody was aware of the fact that Washington certainly was going to be outrushed by Air Force coming into this contest, but it has really been a struggle, as you pointed out, when you have people like Corey Dillon and Rashawn Sheehy. The previous years, 96 and 97, they were able to pull things off. 98 a struggle, and tonight, average yards per carry, 2.7, that just doesn't cut it.
Air Force, in contrast, has rushed for 201 yards. Second and 8. Ewert under pressure, and down he goes. It's Bryce Fisher on the sack. He has 7 this season, and he said coming in he wanted to have Brock Ewert wide-eyed and nervous in the pocket.
Well, Fisher shows his ability to stay with it. Here he comes up, and see, that's a mismatch. There's just no way that the back can block him. Now, I don't know how well he talks, but he certainly sacks better than Brian Herbstreit.
I don't think Mr. Herbstreit has a lot to worry about right now. Well, Brock Ewert does. 3rd and 14 now. Falcons will drop 8 into coverage, and Ewert throws over the middle into the seam of the zone, and he's got Looker there.
Yeah!
Big play, first down, as the high school teammates from Puyallup, Washington hook up. 46-yard pickup.
What happens is that when you are so used to the blitz, see, finally he gets time to throw. Air Force goes to the conventional zone defense, thinking it's 3rd and very long. They generate no pass rush whatsoever, and there's Looker on the deep end. Ewert able to put it right on the money. First down for the Huskies.
And Looker is a guy that was essentially recruited by Brock Ewert off of the Western Washington basketball team.
Yeah.
Said, hey, buddy, I could use your wide receiving skills. 1st and 10. And there is Gerald Harris, the sophomore from Kent, Washington, with a reception stopped by Jason Sanderson. I mean, you're used to coaches and big-time recruiters coming in. You want to come to play for us and all this. Well, number 80, a totally different story. He's playing basketball, and Brock Ewert says, you know, you can catch the ball. You can play at this level. And they had what has now become sort of a famous catch inside a basketball gym, throwing the ball around. And he said, oh, I'm going to give it a shot. Give up hoops. Come play in the Pac-10. And it's worked out. 2nd and 5 for Washington. Desperately in need of some offense and big plays. And Looker was out of bounds that time. Couldn't come down with either feet in bounds as we head down to Jackaroot.
Larry, Looker's been to Hawaii before. In fact, he took in all the sun and fun when he played basketball in a small-time college, in an AIA college. But there was one problem. He got too much sun. He got so sunburned that it affected his play. So all of his Washington teammates, especially Brock Ewert this time, made him load up with sunscreen before he left Seattle.
Very wise move. 3rd and 5. The Hawaiian heat is ferocious, as has the Air Force defense been, and there is Looker trying to reach out to lunge for the first down, and I think he'll be a yard short.
Coming on the short crossing route, Thorsterson, though, is the man who is able to make the tackle, their star. Their star inside linebacker. Now they'll go to Tuia Sisopo here.
On 4th and 1, got to go for it down 32 to 13, even though we're still in the third quarter. Approaching the 2-minute mark. Ewert comes out, Tuia Sisopo in. The sophomore from Woodinville, 6'2", 215 pounds. Excellent running ability. Now he appears to be changing the play. Straight ahead, Pat Connor. I think he got the first down. The fullback, 235-pounder, stopped by Craig Thorstenson.
So all the shifting in motion, much ado about nothing. But it does get him the first down. I'm surprised, really, that they haven't gone with Tui Asisopo a little bit more, if for no other reason than, you know, Heward's getting beat up. And maybe you want a little bit more mobile guy back there because of all the blitzes that the Falcons have been throwing at him.
Well, Air Force has controlled the ball, 21 first downs to only 10 for Washington. And it's still Tui Asisopo at quarterback, so a change of pace here for the Huskies. Play action. Looking. And he's knocked out of bounds. C.J. Zanotti.
You know, one thing that impresses me about Air Force defense, one of the many things that impresses me, is that they might not have the Javon Curse kind of guys, you know, that are these, you know, kind of like genetic mutations in terms of 4.5 and 260, but they always seem to arrive at the ball. They always seem to be in the right spot. And again, I guess this is where you have to give a lot of credit to Cal McCombs, the defensive coordinator, because if coming into this game, I love that the shoot, you know that these guys are not going to beat themselves.
Second and 12, 2 yard loss on the last play. Here comes the blitz. Ewart is back in the game, hands off to Braxton Clement, and he runs right into the awaiting blitzers, Jason Sanderson among them.
That falls under the heading of sacrificial lamb. At the snap of the ball, Heward knows right now this play is dead because Sanderson's hitting right in the hole. And Cal McCombs, who will be the head coach at Virginia Military Institute in the fall of 1999. And let me tell you something, having had more than a few conversations with that man, I'm impressed with what he does. And so the youngsters there back east are in for a treat playing for this man.
Third and 14. Last time the Falcons were in this situation, they didn't put much pressure on the quarterback, and he came back to haunt them here as you were throwing the out pattern, Jarzynka, at the 23-yard line, short of the first down. So it'll be fourth down again for the Huskies.
Good comeback route, put him in a position to where they can make this fourth down in about two. And once again, Tui Asisopo comes in.
Stopped on the play by Nishong Smog. Tui Asisopo started two games this season, provides more of a running threat. He'll take over as the starting quarterback next season for Washington. And some have suggested maybe he's a better college quarterback, whereas Ewart might be the better pro quarterback. Out of the eye, the give to Clement. Right at the 20-yard line by Tim Curry.
They were a little bit generous on the spot. I think he might have gotten it.
Well, that is pretty close. I'm not sure. They're going to have to bring out the chains to measure on this. But a big hit.
Here's the point of attack, that the blocking is good. Clement is coming a little bit high, but there he just gets stood up in the hole. Well, that's impressive. You know, Curry, as a corner, you think to yourself, at 5'10", 175. Well, you know, maybe he's a good cover guy and a pretty good athlete, but he shows there that he's a bit of a hitter. One thing I neglected to mention for nearly three quarters, and there's a reason for that. I played against that man's father when he was a defensive tackle, Manu Tui Asisopo. And they did not get the first.
Air Force takes over on downs.
There's the man with the big hit. You don't anticipate 175-pounder standing up the tailback in the hole, but that's exactly what happened.
Fisher DeBerry says, way to go, guys. And in Curry's case, giving up 25 pounds, takes on the running back with a full head of steam. Says, come on, bring it on.
I'm so glad we're able to talk about that. It's opposed to my playing with somebody's father. So much better. Thank you.
You have any thoughts about Manu Tui Asisopo as a player?
Yeah, very good defensive tackle. Very good. UCLA product.
Time winding down, third quarter. Morgan's going to throw it. He's got a man. It's Farmer down the sidelines. A foot race to the end zone. Aloha means goodbye. Putting the air into the Air Force today, a 79-yard hookup with his favorite target, Matt Farmer.
Farmer with the hook and go. There's the 360. Butler slips and falls twice. Now right here, you would have thought the Butler would have been able to catch him from behind, but Farmer shows that he's got some giddy up of his own. Two strides per 5 yards and a touchdown for number six.
And Blane Morgan on the day, 9 of 13, 210 yards passing. I don't think anybody could have predicted those kinds of numbers from an Air Force offense that just never passes the ball.
Well, inevitably, when you talk to a team, to an option team, and they always tell you the same thing when you ask the question, can your quarterback throw? And, of course, they go, oh, yeah, yeah, he can throw. But when they said that, you know, they said that Morgan really could throw, we said, well, okay, you know, seeing is believing. Well, you know what, I'm sure, I guess we'd have to go back in the books, but this has to be one of the best throwing games of his career, if not the best. And he really has proven not only does he have an arm, but he's got some touch.
Absolutely. Morgan and Farmer getting it done here to break this game open. Let me tell you about the National Hockey League on ESPN2. It's National Hockey Night tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern Time. The Flyers and the Blackhawks. Philly led by big Eric Lindros and John LeClair trying to stop red-hot Tony Amonte and the Blackhawks. 8 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2, the Deuce.
Tony Amonte leading with 23 goals in the NHL, and now with the trade, Michael Renberg back. They've got the Legion of Doom back.
I didn't know you were a big hockey guy.
I guess I have no life.
They're going to go for two here. And the give is up the middle. It was Becker twisting and turning. He did not make it.
They're going to say he bounced across. I'm a little curious at 38 to 13 why they would do that too, but evidently they're thinking four touchdowns.
That's what it's going to take for a Husky unit that has not been able to generate anything consistently. 7 seconds left in the third quarter. Let me give you some numbers here. The Air Force offense, you know they're going to run the ball. You know they're going to run for 300 yards or something like that. 201 rushing. That's a lot of push-ups coming, guys. 210 passing.
That's amazing balance, but I didn't see Jack. Wasn't Jack going to do the push-ups? Didn't we talk about that earlier? Fisher DeBerry still munching on his gum and has the hard look on his face. He's got to be extremely pleased with what's transpired thus far. No smile sneaking in, though, until the gun.
And Fisher DeBerry getting the Christmas present that he wanted. He was the one guy, you could see it in his eyes, wanted to change things. The postseason struggles that the Air Force has endured in their last three bowl trips. Last year, as Jack Root mentioned, they got clobbered by Oregon. 41-13 in Las Vegas Bowl. And Fisher DeBerry says, if we have to change a whole bunch of stuff, that's fine, because I want to win this game. 38-13. Air Force a quarter and 7 seconds away from achieving 12 victories as David Adams again squib kicks it. And this is Butler. Still on his feet.
Wow, nice run back.
Driving out close to the 50-yard line.
Latoure Butler is trying to make up for getting burned, but it isn't enough. Heward with the interception, and of course, this sets up another score for the Falcons. Look at the hits coming downfield, and of course, there's Spanky in the end zone.
And the deep ball, Matt Farmer, taking it to the house, 38-13, Force.
They say technology gives you the freedom to experience the world, especially when it's so affordable, like Jeep Cherokee Sport. With air, power windows and locks, and remote keyless entry at no extra charge. Cherokee Sport. Now that's a cool way to access the sights you see online.
My dad taught me what it means to be a true fan. What it means to come out and give 110%. Right, Dad?
Yeah!
I'm more the quiet type.
Oh, yeah!
Well, the cold doesn't bother me so much. It's the chili dogs.
Oh,
that's why I bring out the Rolaids.
Rolaids starts to neutralize acid in less than 10 seconds, getting you back on your game fast.
It's just like Grandpa always says. You gotta be your best out here.
Rolaids, R-O-L-A-I-D-S, spells relief.
Mom doesn't make it out to the games. I don't know why.
Temporarily, I work in a cheese place, but I want to play clarinet for a living and write music. Yeah, you want me to name 50 cheeses? Okay. You've got Comté, Swiss Gruyere, Letiva, Scoubine, Coulia, Brie, Brie de Meaux, Mascarpone, a cheese. I don't know, I've seen some cheeses there that I don't believe were of animal origin.
I'm Maximum Protection, the authority for Napa Gold filters. Today's driving conditions are severe, with frequent stopping and road dirt. But I hold 45% more dirt than the leading national brand. And that's important, because I help your engine last longer. So put me to work and get the maximum protection of Napa Gold filters.
Napa, over 200,000 parts, and everyone's important.
And after 13 years, I can finally say I have absolutely no urge to play this game.
New Asteroids is here for PC and PlayStation with 3D graphics, deadlier weapons, and two-player action. It's the most addictive game ever, ever.
Raymond! You're a weak man, Ray.
Asteroids, they're back.
We are back at the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. The Huskies and the Falcons receiving a ticket to paradise. And the sun setting on the Huskies right now. They need a huge comeback here. As we start the fourth quarter at Aloha Stadium, Larry Beal along with Todd Christensen and Jack Arruda on the sidelines. Air Force controlling things with the option and then sprinkling in the passing game. A 38-13 cushion on Christmas Day. Brock Heward, seeing the blitz, says, let's talk it over.
That's not a good sign, not in the fourth quarter.
Well, not when you're running your first play of the quarter, and you're coming out of a break, and Jim Lambright is not a happy man right about now.
Well, as we take a look at the numbers, it is clear as to why this game is being dominated by Air Force. So many times you say that the numbers can lie, not here. Washington with less than 50 yards rushing. Very good. And 2-1 in first downs. So Air Force is doing what they wanted to do coming in, and I'm sure a little bit more. I don't think even Air Force would have told you they'd have thrown that effectively.
Thank you for letting me touch the telestrator, by the way. I always wanted to do that.
Washington has not been very effective in the fourth quarter, having been outscored in every game this season. So this would be, as they say, a statistical anomaly if somehow they can come back in the middle of this fracas.
Well, the lack of a rushing game really won't play into a factor in the fourth quarter. They have to pass virtually every time now, trailing as they are by 25 points.
Well, and you can see, even though it's 38-13, they're still blitzing their corners. They're coming from all angles. This is the 15 minutes that if you're Heward, you can't be terribly excited about, because you know you're going to get hit.
Dropping back to pass. Has plenty of time to throw, and he's going to throw the deep ball. That's going to be pass interference. Andre Desassure was yanked down by Tim Curry.
And Curry knew it. He knew he was beat, and so he decides to pull him down, also knowing that it's a 15-yard penalty.
In the college game as opposed to the NFL.
Yeah, but this makes for an interesting discussion. If you know in that case, and I don't think anybody on the island of Oahu didn't know that Curry did this on purpose, to leave it to the judgment of the official, as opposed to, say, at the next level, how many times you've seen guys' legs get tangled up, they fall down, it becomes a 60-yard penalty. Clearly there, that was a blatant penalty, not only intentional, but that could have caused some problems. Curry's a smart guy. He knew he was beat.
Yeah, unlike the NFL, where the ball would be spotted at the point of the infraction, they'd have first and goal. Instead, they'll get their 15 yards, move the ball up.
The point that I'm making is with regards to, say, they always have to make a judgment call on the face mask, whether or not it was pulled or whether it was not incidental. In that case, clearly that wasn't incidental, so that could have been one where you say, hey, you know, maybe we should spot it at the 5.
So you want a rule change in that sense? Would you like to see
both that? Both levels. Right. There are too many games that everybody out there has watched on the professional level where guys' legs get tangled up, or a game is decided by a questionable interference penalty that ends up being a 40 or 50-yard game. I don't like that.
Pass interference on the deep end. 15-yard penalty, first down.
So the ball will be spotted at the 36-yard line for the Huskies instead of first and goal inside the 10. You know, the problem for the NFL officials, given the season that they've had. I don't think the last thing they want right now is another judgment call opportunity. Brock Ewart needs points and needs them in a hurry. Flips it out to Looker at the 30-yard line, bumped out of bounds by Tony Jones. The Huskies' leading receiver, number 80, Dane Looker, 6'1", 190, a junior.
I believe he has six catches today. So that gives him 70 on the season. Pretty impressive for a guy that 90 yards on those catches. Pretty impressive for a guy that can't be too much of a power forward, right? Well, he's got to be a shooting guard, right? 6'1", 190.
At Western Washington, we told the story earlier, recruited by Brock Ewart to come to the Huskies to bolster their receiving corps, which has been depleted. This is a Husky team that had 10 guys drafted in the NFL last year. There's a completion to Gerald Harris, knifing down to near the 20-yard line, stopped by Tim Curry.
This time, Ewart saw Curry come off the corner, and he immediately went to his man. Curry couldn't blitz quick enough, so he gets it in anticipation. You're going to see from the left of your screen, immediately he's going to step back and get Harris the ball. Now, there's Curry. He turns around, now sprints back and makes the tackle. Great hustle on the part of number five.
First and 10 at the 21-yard line. Fourth quarter action here in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Braxton Clement up the middle. So they run the ball just to keep the Falcons honest. Sean Thomas and Bryce Fisher, the bookend defensive tackles, combining on the stop.
Remember Sean Thomas earlier in the game was with the big blocked field goal. Maybe one of the biggest plays in the game. And as you pointed out, Fisher, a couple of sacks. We've called his name an awful lot tonight.
Now, the defensive coaches stressed to us that these two guys together for Cal McCombs may be the best they've had in tandem at Air Force. Chad Hennings, of course, by himself, was a stud for the Falcons and then in the NFL with the Cowboys. But two guys at the same time. Here comes the blitz again, and Ewart throws it away. That was a good decision. He was going to get clobbered by Jeff Felton.
Well, it was, but you know what? One of the things, and I'm sure that Ewart has not seen this all year in terms of a packed in defense, the blitzes that the Falcons have from so many different angles. And here in the fourth quarter, it's clear that Ewart has what's known as happy feet.
The Washington offense, well, today they've been productive inside the 20. The problem is they haven't gotten to the 20-yard line. Huskies 4 of 11 on third down as they're looking at third and 6 right now. And Ewart looking left, throws back to the right, has a man wide open, and a flag comes in at the tail end of the play. Andre Desassure. And this one may come back for holding.
It's one of those situations where you have your man. This was so far away. Frustrating, certainly, if you're Ewart. You sit in the pocket. You've got your man. Here it is, straight on. Here's the spin move, and the official sees this. That's a takedown. Gotta call it. Gotta call the takedown on number 69, Keith Connell.
10 yards to the spot of the foul. Repeat third down.
Travis Meidinger was the man on the pass rush with his spin move. And that completion, which would have set up the Huskies at about the 5-yard line, wiped out, march them back, and now it's third down and 20. Full receiver pattern with Braxton Clement, a single setback behind Ewart. Throwing over the middle, it's complete. And that is Desassure again, close to the first down marker. See where they give him the forward progress before Jason Sanderson and company pushed him back.
I wonder if it's his size or the particular routes that he runs, but you look at a 19.6 yards per reception, you say to yourself, why don't we go to this guy more? Why don't we get him the ball more? Because he seems to come up with big plays. Makes a nice catch, takes the collision, sets him up fourth and one. He's had, in fact, his average per catch today has been, what, about 26? I guess so.
You either do very fast math in your head or you have somebody talking to you, feeding you numbers. Gonna take a break. It'll be fourth and one when we come back for the Huskies. Got to make it to get back in the game, trailing 38-13 at Aloha Stadium.
After 40 years in the market, it takes a lot to rattle us.
Call American Century at 1-800-660-0092.
Step up. Learn to see farther. Learn there are teachers who won't allow you to fail. Learn to dance, to draw. Learn that the real challenge doesn't come from the outside, but from within. And that there's more to you than you ever knew. Be all you can be.
Exclusive presentation of Bowl Week and the 1998 Jeep Oahu Bowl is presented by the all-new Jeep Grand Cherokee, the most capable sport utility ever.
Welcome back, Larry Beal, along with Todd Christensen, Jack Arute. It's 4th-and-1 for the Huskies, and that offensive line that averages 6'5½, 307 pounds, needs 1 yard here. In at quarterback, and the sneak and the pile moves to about the 10-yard line, but not the surge that you might expect.
I was thinking that he was overdue to carry the ball. This is about the 6th or 7th time that he's been in the game, and each time he's been handing off. I would have thought this is his chance to get the ball and go, and sure enough, he did get the first.
He got the first down, but not running in open space. There wasn't a lot open there, but he heads to the sidelines, and back comes Brock Ewart. Now, Jim Lambright obviously thinks that Ewart gives them the better chance to get back into this game, throwing the football. First and 10. And here is Ewart scrambling, losing the football, dribbling it out of bounds. Otherwise, I think he would have gone in for the touchdown.
Looked like it. He had the four wides out there, and they spread people out. And once he broke contain, it looked like he had an opportunity to go to the end zone. Take a look. He's going to come right at you. Breaks contain. Now here he goes. He switches to his right hand, and it just pops out. Just pops out. Fortunately for him, it came back to him out of bounds.
Yeah, we've seen a couple of crazy bounces like that today, where guys are just running and the ball flies out and they dribble it to themselves. Braxton Clement being helped off the field.
Now, once again, not unlike the other fumble earlier of Looker, they move it back to the original point of the fumble. Not that, don't get me wrong, not that Heward tried to do it there, but that's the rule.
Well, and Ewart goes to the bench, and Tuiasosofo comes in. Look at that total yardage by the Air Force. 411 to 295, the advantage, as Tuiasosofo on 2nd down and 6 will go from the shotgun. They can get a first down without getting a touchdown. He's going to follow his blockers right up the middle and into the end zone. And there was the running ability that Todd Christensen was talking about with Tuiasosofo. A 7-yard scamper up the middle with a convoy in front. And the Huskies are on the board again.
Nice burst of speed on the part of Tuiasosofo. He comes out of the shotgun, goes with the quarterback draw, has the lead blocker in both the guard and fullback. They both make blocks. And number 11 able to get into the end zone easily.
Tuiasosofo with his eighth rushing touchdown of the season. He averages 7.6 a carry. This is a guy who can tote the ball. And they go with Eward now for the two-point play. This is curious. Throwing the slant for Juergens, incomplete.
Good coverage. Tui Asasopo, I'm surprised that they didn't leave him in and let him run the option or something to that effect. But, of course, offensive coordinator Scott Linehan had pointed out that they will certainly make some adjustments with Tui Asasopo next year, because clearly he's not the same. He's a very different quarterback.
So the Huskies get on the board for the first time in the second half as we head down to Jackaroo.
Hey, guys, I'm with Diane Jackson, who's the senior manager of Jeep National Communication. And, Diane, this is a first for you, a first for the Jeep Aloha, Jeep Oahu Bowls, doubles on Christmas Day. Your impression?
Oh, Jack, we are just simply enthused about the whole thing. This is an inaugural Jeep Oahu Bowl. The crowd has been enthusiastic. The community has been rallying around, and I mean, it's just been wonderful for everyone. And
now,
I think it just gets bigger and bigger, and will grow from here.
I also understand that as part of the festivities, the College Football Hall of Fame are going to take some of the memorabilia from here and put it on display in South Bend.
Yes, we were advised of that once I arrived in Hawaii, and Bowl Games of Hawaii told us about it, and we're just so pleased that it's almost as if, again, the Trotter and Jeep is a part of that.
That's terrific. And guys, I want to show you a sign here, a promo for coming up next. But what I want to do is paraphrase Lee Corso. Not so fast, my friends.
Speaking of, SportsCenter coming up next. Rich Eisen and Linda Cohn will be along. The battle for the NFL playoffs, the Aloha Bowl, and blue-gray game highlights in part five of what's really been a very interesting interview with Bobby Knight. Digger Phelps holding court with the General as the Falcons take over. McKay out to the 22-yard line. And the Falcons, there's Arthur again.
Arthur's happy.
I'm telling you, Arthur is a bad bird.
I'm telling you, Blane Morgan's been his Lancelot, boy. He's been doing everything right.
Arthur flying back to the mainland after this game.
What do you think? How do you like Arthur's chances against the War Eagle if they were to go head-to-head? What do you think?
A good question. Good question. We can make that match on Friday Night Fights on the Deuce, you know. First and 10 as Morgan goes tumbling down, just tripped over his own feet. Stuck in the backfield. Take a look at the Air Force attack today, and this is surprising. You figure they're going to run for a ton. 201, they actually throw the ball for 210 today.
Interesting here, if you notice, you would think that at this point maybe they're just going to go with the fullback up the middle, but instead Fisher DeBerry and his staff have decided that no, we've got to do some things, and Blane Morgan certainly has been the catalyst for everything that has happened both on the ground and in the air.
Second and 12, play action, they're going to keep going to the air, underneath route, and it's complete. And that is Matt Farmer, Morgan's favorite receiver. He got dumped at the end of the play. Farmer, the junior from Pella, Iowa.
Come on, you know what? They got to throw one ball to Kenneth Chandler, 83, their tight end. I want to see him throw one ball to that guy.
Just as a tight end thing?
This guy, yeah, it's got to be. It's tough being a tight end in an option offense, although Keith Jackson certainly made the most of it in his days at Oklahoma.
Well, the funny thing is I read an article on Chandler. This was before the season, and he said he really wanted to establish himself as a receiver and not just a blocker, as you watch Morgan power his way for a first down out to the 35-yard line. And, well, Chandler, big number 83, 6'3", 250, a junior. He established himself as a wide receiver. One reception, 12 yards. That is a dynamic receiver in the Air Force offense. You're giving him a hard time here, but you know they have done a terrific job of throwing the football today.
Good-looking young man, tough guy.
But, I mean, you can talk better than anybody about what it's like to just line up on the end of the line and go straight ahead and not have the opportunity to catch the ball. I mean, you lived some of that, but mostly out in the open field, scampering away from little defensive backs that you've run over.
There's the reverse again.
Dylan Newman. And the Huskies play it well. They drop him in the backfield.
Once again, it's the Rover man who has made so many plays today for them. Nigel Burton, who's able to smell it out. Two times it was effective. The third time, the defense is waiting on it.
Now, interesting talking to Burton before the game because he said, you know, if you look into the backfield to try to figure out where the option is going, you're in big trouble because there's going to be a guy chopping your knees out from under. You got to read your keys. You got to read your line. And he's been in on some big plays and tipped a couple of balls that could have changed the outcome of the game on the options,
right?
Second and 11, under the 10-minute mark, straight up the middle. It's Matt Kuroda running hard out to the 44-yard line. First time he's carried the ball in the game. Wandami Davis, redshirt freshman on the stop.
Well, and Matt's got some fresh legs. He wants the opportunity to get in here and make the most of when he finally gets the ball. There he is, breaks one, two. There's the third tackle. I think he's going down. He's pounding straight ahead, breaks four or five tackles. That's a great run. Never run out of those tough fullbacks to go straight ahead, do they?
Third down and one. As you see the numbers for Perota this season, and Blane Morgan will call timeout. Under 9 minutes to go, and the clock is on the side of the Falcons, just trying to grind it down so they can get the Christmas present that they came to Hawaii for, leading in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl.
Day 82. Coldest day yet. Even the dogs won't move. Still no radio contact, and supplies are running low.
I brought you some cookies and some nice hot cocoa. Bye-bye, dear.
No matter how bad conditions get, there are a few things you can always count on. The Go Anywhere Jeep Cherokee is just one of them. Now get a Cherokee and get all these features at no extra charge.
Giving NFL Game Day 99 better graphics and gameplay was easy. The hard part was deciding between all the new end zone celebrations.
Baby, yeah!
Party!
That's nice.
Looking good, Terrell.
No! I ain't dead!
Just fine.
Less is more. But hey, when the results are game this real, it's worth the trouble.
Stop that, please.
Ew.
Thank you.
Please stay strong.
Record-setting quarterbacks, Purdue's Drew Brees, duels with Kansas State's Michael Bishop. The Builders Square Alamo Bowl, Kansas State versus Purdue at 8:30, Tuesday on ESPN.
Welcome back. Mele Kalikimaka is the Hawaiian way to say Merry Christmas. All kinds of trees, Santas, everything you can imagine in Waikiki, dressed up for Christmas. Larry Beal, Todd Christensen, and Jack Arute. Talked Todd into wearing the Santa hat early in the day, since discarded. And the Falcons trying to discard it with the Huskies here. Under 9 minutes to go. As they'll pound the football. Run. Matt Perota up the middle. Let's go down to Jack Arute.
Guys, I've replaced my traditional holiday lei from Hawaii with a fighter squadron scarf. This is the 10th anniversary of a tradition that the Air Force Academy football players engage in. Each player has an individual scarf from an Air Force fighter squadron somewhere around the world. They wear it during warm-ups. They hang it in their locker rooms. I don't know. What do you think? Roger, Red Baron, I'm ready to go.
Jack Arute is styling.
Jack would look good in the sop with camel.
First and 10. The pitch. On the outside is Matt Rios, the junior from Golden, Colorado. Out of bounds. At about the 47-yard line of Washington.
Larry, that's the 12th Air Force player to carry the ball today. That's amazing.
And here is the total offense for the Falcons, beating out their regular season average of 393 and a half, 442 today on the Husky defense. And this has been a problem for Washington all season long, giving up over 400 yards a game. Tough to win a lot of games doing that. Second and 5. Straight ahead, Jeremiah Laster with the carry.
That makes 13 then.
You are
I'm impressed with the fact that they just come and wave.
Yeah. This is a great offense if you're a running back. You're going to get some shots.
You do. You do want to get that opportunity.
If you're Ken Chandler, you're just, oh, please, somebody look at me. Throw me the ball. Going to measure for the first down here. While we have a second, we're going to talk about Quilario Brown. Talked to him before the game. And he was talking about, you know, playing football and the demands of football. But he said, come on, compared to cadet survival training course, this is nothing where you spend a week in the woods. They give you a little bit of food, not a lot. You know, when you have to catch your own food in order to eat, you're going to be disciplined. You're going to get tough mentally. You don't often hear the phrase, how would you like your squirrel served, sir?
No, you don't. Last time I caught my food was when it spilled out of the microwave. I had to make it.
Did you make the catch? Did you make the catch?
Yeah, I made the catch.
You made the grab. Third and one. And I'm not sure this play is going to count. The whistles blow as
did
the multiple road.
In the course of conversation, you had to have asked him, where did Quilario come from?
Well, where it came from, I don't know.
Oh, come on.
That's just the name they gave him. He said he had trouble spelling his name as a kid. I think it's Spanish for Larry, actually.
Oh.
Dead ball prior to the snap. Ball start on the offense. 5-yard penalty.
So the play comes back. Forget the first down. We're checking here in the record books, and the last time that the Falcons, as we look at
the
cue, Quilario Brown.
You gave him some pubs, so he goes back.
So he went back in. Last time the Falcons passed for more yards than they rushed was 1989 against Notre Dame. They ran for 168 and threw for 306, but lost the game 41-27. Stats have been fairly balanced in this one, but there's no question about the outcome at this point. As Morgan again is going to go back to pass. 32-yard line. Matt Farmer again.
I got to tell you, the coaches were right. Farmer is a real receiver. And, you know, that throw right there, pivoting and throwing the deep hook route to the 30-yard line, that's an impressive throw.
My bad. It was Dylan Newman.
Well, regardless, the throw is the thing. Pivots back once again, kind of that run-and-shoot shuffle. Look at how far this ball has to travel and across the field. Newman makes a nice catch. That's a great throw by Morgan. You know, they talked about the fact that, you know, being Bo's younger brother, that he couldn't do all the things that Bo could do. I'm not sure he's not a little bit better thrower.
And the passing attack, as they give to Perota again. The passing yards now 238 for the Falcons, 226 on the ground. So pretty unusual. As we hit the 7-minute mark in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl.
Let me go way, I mean, just intergalactic out on a limb and say that's my MVP.
You know, you're a man that makes bold statements. I think you're in good shape with that one. Although early on, Jamal Singleton had a couple of touchdown runs.
Well, see, the great thing about their defense is that everybody makes plays. You don't have one or two guys that are stars. Everybody contributes.
Keep grinding that clock down. Second and 11, straight up. Well, actually, he kept it, did Blane Morgan. Darrell Daniels on the stop. Coming into this game, here were the stats. Fewest completions by teams going to bowls. And Air Force, the fewest, only 85. But they have passed so effectively today. Morgan, 11 for 15 in the air.
Well, again, it's effectiveness. And, of course, the big stat now, the stat du jour, as it were, now in contemporary football, is passes, is yards per attempt. That's what everybody is looking at now. And, of course, in this case, it's about 16, you know, yards passing per attempt. The guy's been very effective.
Timeout Air Force with 5:49 to go in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. The Falcons want to take the trophy home on Christmas Day in the islands.
It's a starry December on Media One Home Theater. Your pay-per-view on Media One Home Theater.
Outside, it's got more power than any SUV in its class. Inside, it's as quiet as the open.
Oh, baby, baby, how was I
wild card berth in the AFC. The Jags lead the AFC Central Monday night, 8 Eastern, on ESPN. ESPN and ABC, your primetime home for NFL football.
You know, I was about to say, Greg Ellis, the defensive end for the Dallas Cowboys. I have no problem with him. I think he's a pretty good player. But to think that Dallas, like so many, 19 others could have drafted Randy Moss. What would the Cowboys be now if they had Moss and Urban?
Well, that's easy to say now, but there were a lot of character questions about Randy Moss coming out.
No. It was like the world according to Garp. After it happened to Phillips, it was like when the plane ran into the house, right? Okay, we'll buy it. This will never happen again. I think that he was very aware of that, and I think that maybe some of those general managers were just a little too careful. And I said that before the draft, by the way, so I don't want to be okay. One of those guys that's jumping on the bandwagon.
All right, then you're on the record. 5:42 to go, fourth quarter. Here is Torrey Butler. Spun around, heading back the other way towards Tim Curry. And the Falcons finish him off. A lot of fighting, Torrey Butler, though.
Well, he's a good kick returner. Averaged 28 yards per return. Second in the nation. He can do it.
Deshaun Smog on the stop. It looks like Butler is shaken up. Had a lot of guys piled on top of him at the end of the play. Air Force in their last four possessions. Field goal, touchdown, touchdown, touchdown. Aloha.
Yeah, I noticed that on the sidelines for the first time in the entire game, you finally saw Fisher DeBerry smiling. 5'9", 160-pounder, only a sophomore. He's their best cover guy. He had their most pass breakups. He is their... And with two more years of eligibility, Butler's going to do a lot of good things for the Huskies.
Fisher DeBerry, winningest coach in Air Force history, led the Falcons to 9 bowl games in 15 years. Going to be very happy with the play of a Farmer and the rest of his receivers and their whole team effort today, offense and defense, as the Huskies throw short to Looker.
I don't think people really appreciate what it is to do what he has done at a service academy. You know, the limitations in terms of recruiting, both academically, you know, the size factor because of flyers, you know, things of this nature. And year in and year out, they're competitive. Number 13 coming into this game.
And complete again to Looker. Knocked out of bounds by Jason Sanderson. You know, Looker, we talked about him coming over from playing basketball. And he was in dreamland after the first two games. He was playing major college football. Last second victory over Arizona State for the Huskies. Then they beat BYU. And he was thinking, wow, this is incredible. We beat one of the teams that might be a national championship contender. Maybe we can. And then they visited Lincoln, Nebraska.
Yeah, dose of reality there.
55-7 was the final, and the Huskies started to spiral and wobble through the middle part of the season after that game. They throw it out to George Rizinka at the 40-yard line, and he gets out of bounds to stop the clock with 4:50 to play.
One of the advantages, though, today, which is an interesting side note or sidebar to this game, is that Washington, on their 1999 schedule, Colorado, Oregon, and Air Force, all three teams they'll have next year. So maybe if nothing else, then Lambright's got a head start on scouting them.
Well, the funny thing is they get the Gatorade bath ready for Fisher DeBerry. I'm not sure, is that part of military protocol? Are you allowed to do that?
It isn't. From military protocol, it's supposed to be saltpeter. I don't know if you're aware of that, but it is.
I'm glad you waited till 4:50 to go in this game before going that way. Here's the draw to Willie Hurst. Willie's got some running room, the 40-yard line. And he's taken down in Air Force territory by Tony Jones, gain of 23. Let's go to Jack Arute.
Well, guys, let's update you on the condition of Torrey Butler. You can see him right here, and he's still grimacing a little bit. According to the doctors for Washington, he's bruised some ribs.
Well, fortunately, he'll have some time to heal up for next season. But talking about the schedule, I'm not sure that looking at the films, Jim Lambright is going to feel real good about knowing he's got the Falcons again in September. That ball is picked up for grabs and will fall harmlessly incomplete as Corey Nelson was trying to make a play on it, the sophomore from North Carolina.
Now, this is one of those that they'll set fire to, I'm sure. That not a lot to learn from this, other than the fact that maybe some tendencies of what they do offensively, that certainly is something for them to look at for 99. But it's a different, you know, it's always a different
group. Different quarterback,
different
Morgan playing his final game. And for Jim Lambright, the strange thing is they haven't played the Falcons. This is their first meeting, these two teams, since 1980, and then they're going to play them twice within 10 months. So, an unusual matchup, but things worked out schedule-wise for the Oahu Bowl. Oh, Chuck Sinka takes a hit from Tony Jones, who had him measured.
Well, Air Force has predominantly reserves in the game now, Larry, but they have proven that even though they may not be the caliber of the starters, there's nothing less in terms of their intensity and ability to hit people. And Cal McCombs is still coaching like it's 14-13. Nice collision.
Third and six for Brock Ewart, and his Huskies throws underneath, and that ball is intercepted by Jason Sanderson through the hands of Dane Looker, which is a pretty rare occurrence, but sort of the way things have gone in this game for the Huskies.
Yeah, microcosm of the season for Ewart right there. He's, you know, if he didn't have bad luck, he'd have no luck at all. Little slant route. Looker, his most dependable guy, puts it on his hands, maybe a little bit too much steam. Sanderson, the lone starter, as best I could tell, still in the game, makes the pick.
And the senior from Afton, Wyoming, makes the pick. Ewart, third interception of the game. And let's put this in context, because we were talking about Brock Ewart, and he struggled throughout the season, a 6-5 record, didn't have a supporting cast. With this game, does he help himself at all? I mean, for NFL scouts looking at him, and is it a game that anybody should put a lot of credence in and measure his abilities in because of the fact that he's got a depleted cast around him?
It's a good question, but the one thing that stands out to me, if you are a scout looking at it, is you can't question his toughness. I don't know how many times offhand that he was sacked, but I do know that he was hit at least a dozen times, and he certainly showed his toughness. You know, you look at his body, and that, you say to yourself, wait a minute, there's a guy that's going to get hurt easily. Well, against these Falcons who fly all over the field, and they will hit you. Ewart proved his mettle by hanging in there.
New quarterback for the Air Force Falcons, Cale Bonds, a junior from Englewood, Colorado. He's done a nice job this season as the backup. Flags fly, whistles blow.
He was the starter against Brigham Young in the WAC championship game. Did some good things throughout the season, did Cale. Dare I say, U.S. Bonds.
I thought you were going to go with a James Bond kind of. Are you going to give me a little shaken but not stirred? And
no.
For your eyes only?
No.
3:52 to go, and the Falcons with a 45-19 lead. We're diving in deep to the film material right now. One thing we should talk about. Handoff goes up the middle to Ryan Hill. Now, this is history made today at Aloha Stadium with the first ever in the Aloha Classics. We had the Oahu Bowl, but earlier in the day was the Aloha Bowl, and the first time that bowl games, the doubleheader, has ever been staged. Lenny and Marsha Klompas.
Give them a lot of credit for doing that. I think it took a lot of courage to go out and do that, and certainly the people that have come here have not been cheated in terms of entertainment and an awful lot of points, too.
How about offense? 94 points in the first game, won by Colorado, 51-43 over Oregon. Give up the middle to Hill again. And in this game, we've got 64 points. Two MVPs in the first ever Jeep Oahu Bowl. Well, there's the man, Blane Morgan. The passing yards, 267, couple of touchdowns. Running the option offense, and for the Huskies, Brock Ewart. Who tried as he might, but just could not come up with the big plays to keep the Huskies in it. 2.5 to play at Aloha Stadium. Here is the pitch to Jeremiah Laster, and they gang tackle him just past the 25-yard line. And one of the thoughts with staging the doubleheader that the Klompas family had is sort of as a precursor to a national playoff system. Your thoughts on that, given the bowl championship series, which is coming up?
Well, I like the idea. I think maybe it was Gene Wojciechowski that actually had the idea of what's wrong with the Final Four. And if indeed you had that Final Four sort of situation, then a back-to-back, a doubleheader would really make sense. That would be fun. But as right now, you know, this is one of the...
Ally McBeal, Jane Krakowski, and Calista Flockhart on their Golden Globe nominations.
Previously on Ally McBeal.
Ever heard of Nell Porter?
Sub-Zero now?
She's looking to leave Goodman Dale. Now, she's got serious portables.
Will she meet?
I'm told she's asked about us.
Hi.
Oh, hi, Nell.
Paul.
It's John.
Oh, right. Listen, Ally, I'm really considering joining up, but I would like to talk to a woman's woman first.
The front lawn that had a little bit of snow, but the back lot, the parking lot, there were drifts that were over 2 feet, over, like, people's tires of their cars. Yeah.